afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Robert Jordan Pee Stadium. And for this afternoon's 59th edition of the annual Hall of College Football Contest. It is now my pleasure to introduce those seniors who will participate today in their final cross-college football rivalry. The Hall cheerleading squad, coached by Danielle Simon and assisted by Angela Berkeley. Each of the cheerleaders will be accompanied by their parents and or family members. Conard Castillo.
Thanks, Chris.
And now, the senior Warriors of Paul, under the leadership of Coach Frank Robinson. Each escorted by parents and our family members, manager Sam Weinberg.
All right, so this one right here, we're going to be on the wide shot. You won't really be zooming in that much. You can get a little bit tighter instead of just having a but
Aaron Palucci.
Yeah. Okay, great. Thanks, Mary.
I can only do it when she tells me, or should I be doing it?
Yeah, she'll tell you all about
it. Marco Chimbe.
But yours is
going
to be moving regardless. If you ever need help, you got your little headset.
Giovanni Garcia.
If you ever need to talk to her, you just press the talk to anybody.
Cool.
You can test it right now.
Testing.
Jack Canega.
Hey, can you hear me? Yes, I can.
Austin Kerr.
I'm going to walk you down to that one over there. Okay. You should be good on battery because you're plugged in the door.
Cool.
That one down there has battery.
All right.
So you
can do it. Harrison Newman.
Cool. I'll be here.
Nice.
Would you? Will. I think also Will.
Oh, square. Really
easy.
Diana.
Angel Rodriguez. Captain Tyler Strickland. Jordan Weinstock. Captain John Wells. Matthew Wilcox. And Jacob Zetoff.
Thank you.
A final round of applause, please, for Paul's football class of 2016. Now, please help me to acknowledge Conard's senior cheerleaders, coached by Monica Bronzak and Andrea Walker. Each will be accompanied by parents and or family members. Aruma Alicia Collins. Riffy Gator.
Thank you.
players, beginning with Joshua Augusto. Kayson Banks.
I forgot all about that story. That was a good story.
I've been trying to spread the word. I got flyers here. I've got flyers up in the hallways. I emailed town hall, the local media. So, it's a really good show.
Yeah, I can't wait.
I would have, honestly, coach, I would have liked to have watched it.
Maureen Green.
I have a copy.
Like we wouldn't have fun doing, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Oh, yeah.
It would take us like
Elijah Hale.
Stop that. Eddie, remember this?
Yes. Yeah.
Joshua Henry.
Right. 600-yard gym.
Bob Iverson. Truly personify the brotherhood of Conard football.
Sooner or later. Yeah, that's how you make money.
Eddie, what's it like the freshman game the other day?
It's a good game. Yeah, it's so
Thank you also to our Conard Cup Band, directed by Mr. Scott Porter, our Cup Band from Hall, and the director James Antonucci. Also, our chief physicians, Dr. Douglas McGilpin, Dr. Greg Zarnicki, and Dr. Cliff Rios.
And we welcome you to McKee Stadium as the War Chief Sports Council and WHC-TV 5 proud to present West Hartford High School football. Today, the 59th renewal as the Hall Warriors visit the Conard Chieftains. Hi again, everybody. Pete Lammer along with Chris Grace and our fine crew led by Jen Evans. The climax of the regular season, always compelling, and the stakes are high. Conard can punch their ticket to the Class AA playoffs with a win, while Hall can play spoiler and end their season above 500 with a victory. Conard 7-2, their seventh in the playoff chase, with the top eight making it to the quarterfinals on December 1st. The Chieftains come off a 58.600-yard effort in beating down Newington. They also lost running back Jordan Dorfman to a broken leg. So more work for the all-conference tailback Nate Richam, who comes off his third 200-yard effort of the season. Hall, they've had a roller coaster season. Lost two, won three, lost two, now on a two-game winning streak. And their senior quarterback Matt Wilcox and running back Tyler Strickland lead a pretty good offense as well. Now both of these coaches, Frank Robinson, Matt Sersothamo, grew up around the game. Their dads coached in it many times. They played in it, and now they oppose each other on the sideline. Conard leads the all-time series 32-23-3, but Hall has won the last four. We're going to defer now to Bill Watson, the public address announcer, for this current announcement.
Conard was the head wrestling coach for the years 1968 to 1986. His teams won 5 state championship titles and 13 league championships. His astounding overall record of 235 wins.
Performing the coach hunt today is George's daughter, Beverly Kelly.
Coin toss about to take place. Captains from both sides on. Chris Grace, one of these games, you just throw the records out the window. It's all about emotions. It's all about the battle of West Hartford.
Yeah, Pete, there's nothing better than rivalry football. And today we've got two teams. These kids grew up together. They grew up playing with each other and against each other. They circle this game. This is the game everyone looks forward to. It's a full crowd on both sides. It's a beautiful day. It's football weather. It's in that 40 to 50 range, a little bit of a breeze. It feels right. It's that holiday season, and we're ready to go today. You got two teams that have a lot to play for. Hall has the bragging rights to play for. And Conard has a chance to maybe play in the playoffs. So there's a lot on the line, and all that's left is to settle it between this 120-yard gridiron, and hopefully for both teams it'll be a well-played game and we'll have a close competitive contest like always.
Hall's going to get the ball first as both teams rally near midfield. Bob Heimgartner is the referee, and he'll be in charge this afternoon. Talked about the loss of Dorfman and what a big loss that is for Conard in terms of their offense. Really puts all the pressure on Richam.
Yeah, we know Richam's been here for a long time. He played as a sophomore, he played as a junior, and now he's starring as a senior. It's a great opportunity for him to put his legacy next to Jonathan Esposito and other great Conard running backs and establish himself in this game today, because this is the game that people remember, Hall versus Conard, and today's his opportunity to shine as a senior. They're going to have to turn to him. There's nowhere else to turn. It's going to be him and Flaherty controlling the ball on the ground, and if they're going to be successful, it's going to be because of number 6 carrying the football.
A moment of silence before our national anthem here.
While we are here for the first time without his presence, the legacy and spirit he has left behind are still alive and those being touched throughout his life. On the field, on the sidelines, in the stands, and in this community and beyond. Please join me in a moment of silence as we remember Coach Robinson.
Now the playing of our national anthem, performed by Conard Pep Band.
And the national anthem here at McKee Stadium, as performed by the Conard Pep Band, after we observed a moment of silence for Frank Robinson, the longtime three-decade head coach of the Hall Warriors, who passed away last February, as you heard Bill Watson announce over the public address announcement here earlier today. The War Chief Sports Council would like to thank its sponsors and supporters for making last week's tailgate fundraiser an enormous success. The tailgate netting over $10,000, which will in turn be used to benefit student athletes at both Hall and Conard High Schools. The War Chief Sports Council is a booster club supporting all athletic teams at both West Hartford High Schools. And for more information, please visit warchief.net. That's war-chief.net. Paul McConnell, Dennis Swanton worked tirelessly to build the cause. Please offer your support when you can. So just moments away from the opening kickoff here this afternoon. Conard 7-2. Hall checking in at 5-4. And the Conard Chieftains last won this contest back in 2010. They were a big underdog that day. They ran into a fellow, Chris Grace, by the name of John Esposito before he went to Princeton. Rushed for over 245 yards that day. He had a 65-yard touchdown scamper on the opening play from scrimmage that really set the tone. And Chieftains trying to win for the first time since then, 5 years ago.
It's a great opportunity for Conard, and in these rivalry games, like you said, you really can throw the record out the window. So for Conard, they have to announce their presence early in this game with physical football and overwhelm a younger and less experienced Hall team if they want to have success here this afternoon at McKee Stadium.
Jaden Shaw, Theo Blashinsky back deep to receive for the Warriors as Conard will kick it off. Finn Cahill has the ball teed up at the 40-yard line as we're just about set to go. Here we go, and it's a short pooch kick, and it's fielded by Wells, who went up in the air and caught it at the 49, and that's where the Warriors will put it in play. First down and 10, kicked it to the wrong man as Wells, who's 6'4", leaped high into the air to come down with that one.
Yeah, you know, Pete, sometimes you want to make a play to get some momentum. It looked like they were trying an onside pooch kick. Unfortunately, they kicked it to the guy with the best leaping ability, the best height, and the best hands on the team, and Wells was ready for it, had that scouted, and now Hall has great field position to start this game.
Matt Wilcox is the quarterback, Tyler Strickling the running back, the wideouts, Wells, Booth, and Mike Ferengia. Up front, Harrison Newman at center, the guards, Kyle Conlon and Gio Garcia, the tackles, Colin Fitzsimons, and Brandon Beecher. First down, right at midfield. Three wides to the right as the quarterback Wilcox out of the gun. Back to pass, throws near side, is complete, has his man. There's Wells again. 5-yard pickup out of bounds at the 45. It'll be second and five.
You know, Pete, earlier this year when we saw Hall take on Southington, Wells was one of the few guys that looked athletically equal to the Southington Blue Knights. He's going to be a guy to focus on, and for Hall to be successful, they're going to have to go through their big wide receiver.
Gain of five on that short pass completion. Second and five for the Warriors at the Conard 45, as you can see, spotted on the near hash. Wilcox takes the snap, hands it off straight ahead. And they'll get about three as they get down to the 42-yard line. Tyler Strickling on the carry, his first of the day. Pick up of three, it'll be third and short.
For those of you who haven't seen Hall, they have two different styles of runners. Strickling is more north-south and Blashinsky is more east-west. I think Strickling is the way to go against this physical Conard team. We'll see the first carry as any indication that's how they're going to go this afternoon.
Strickland coming in, averaging 7.9 yards per carry. Third and two at the Conard 42-yard line. Long snap count. Hand off to Strickland. Tries to run to his right, and he is going to be brought down shy of the first down. Big defensive front able to collapse and bring him down short of the first down. Fourth and short, and already it is an interesting decision for Frank Robinson III. Probably will go for it.
Yeah, I don't think there's a decision here. He's going to go for it. They got great field position. They're in that in-between zone. They can't kick it. Punting doesn't really help you. Fourth and short, rivalry game. Let's go get it.
Twin tailbacks to either side of Wilcox, two wides to the right. It's Wells lined up near to the left side. And he wants to throw for it. And it's complete. He's got Ferengia, and he's got the first down inside the 35. Pickup of about seven, and they'll move the chains. Another instance where they're able to take advantage of a big height advantage for the wide receiver.
Yeah, it was just a great job by Wilcox of delivering the ball on time, putting it in a place where his guy can make the play, and no one else in his big, tall tight end made a big play to move the chains, and now Hall's marching towards the end zone.
Fifth play of the drive upcoming. It's a first and 10 at the Chieftains 35-yard line. Hand off to Strickland straight ahead with running room, and he's finally tripped up, but inside the 30, down to the 29. Gain of about a half dozen on the play. Shoestring tackle prevented him from getting the first down and maybe even more, Chris.
Yeah, I'm telling you, I really like what I've seen from Strickling, and it seems like since the last time we called their game, he's getting more action, and I can understand why. He gets more than what's blocked for him on every play.
Second down and four at the 29-yard line. Two wides to either side, single setback. Hand off again to Strickling. Goes off the right side and is going to be brought down shy of the 25-yard line, bringing up another third down and short upcoming for Hall. Let's set that counter defense for you. Up front, it's Nick Kramus along with Owen Hendricks and Dylan Forsberg. The linebackers are Steven Bintz, Lucas DeCellis, Zach Bohm, and Tyler Carson. The DBs, Jordan Weinstock and Devin Richards at the corners, Chris Lund and Theo Bolshinsky at safety. Third down upcoming. Third down and about one at the 26-yard line. Strickling to the left of the quarterback, Wilcox. Takes the snap, hands off, and he's got the first down and more at the 20, at the 15, and finally brought down at about the 12-yard line. Gain of about 16 on the play, and another first down for Halls. They're in the red zone.
I mean, there's nothing modern or complex about what they're doing right now. It's just old school north-south power football, and Strickling is the perfect back to execute that type of scenario. And third and short is the perfect situation for a runner just like him. Big play, and now they're in a chance to really put the pressure on Conard.
Clock running inside, 8:45 to play in the opening quarter. Hall on the move, first down and 10 at the 12-yard line. Lobs it up corner of the end zone, and it is intended for Wells. And it's a touchdown. Wells comes down with it. It was just a question of whether he got the 1 foot in bounds, but he brought it right down in front of Reale, the quarterback. And just like that, the Hall Warriors, in 3.5 minutes, march right down the field and at 8:33 take a 6-0 lead.
I mean, we said it, Pete. Against Southington, we called for this. Wells and Strickling, and that's what they're doing. Those two guys were the critical members of Hall on that drive, and Wells just went up and high-pointed that football. We saw it on the onside kick, we see it on that fade pass. 6-0 Hall, extra point pending.
Aaron Bellucci's kick, and it is good, just inside the right upright. And with a timeout on the field, it's 7-0 Hall with 8:33 to go here in the opening quarter. The Ward Chief Sports Council would like to thank our many fine sponsors, including at the all-state level, the Keating Insurance Agency, MACA Plumbing and Heating, Reed and Reach PC Counselors at Law, ESPN, Conard and Hall PTO, and Mr. and Mrs. Jonathan Gibson. At the captain's level supporters, Hartford Distributors, Franklin Fine Beers, Cork and Bottle, the Babe Ruth Organization, Coastal Tool, and Rob Lutgeon. And at the All-Conference, Allied Printing, and the Hartford Golf Club. Thanks to one and all from the War Chief Sports Council. Their contributions make broadcasts like these possible. Hate to say it early in the first quarter, Chris, but it's a big answer time now for the Conard Chieftains after the big underdog Hall Warriors get on the board first and march right down the field in a nine-play drive, no nonsense.
Yeah, I mean, just watching that drive, Pete, there's no doubt in my mind that Hall's here to stay. They're going to be here the whole afternoon. And that drive was simple. It was basic. I mean, they just ran north-south, and then they finished the drive off by throwing it up to their big, tall 6'3 wide receiver. Conard's going to have to stop the run. If they can't get more penetration on Strickling, they're going to be in trouble because Hall was getting great pushes on that drive and picking up easy yardage.
Spencer Witter will get set to kick off. Jones among those deep as it's angled to the far side of the field. Jones catches it at the 25, tries to reverse his field, and it's going to be brought down shy of the 30 with a flag down on the play. So pending the flag, just a four-yard return for Jones. Probably will go against Conard and will back them up into their first down and 10 situation.
Pete, we talked about it. This is a Conard team that's without one of their bell cows, Jordan Dorfman, and now they're going to be backed up even further following this penalty. They're going to be half the distance to the goal. So they're going to have to go some 88 yards to find the back of the end zone and even up this score. It's going to be interesting to see how they approach this without Dorfman in the backfield.
Absolutely, Chris. Declan Flaherty, he gets the start at quarterback for the Chieftains. Nate Richam at tailback. The wideouts, Byron Jones, Jack Ryan, and Kasan Banks up front. Josh Henry at center. Connor Swanton and Augusto as the pass is complete far side to about the 22-yard line. Tackles are Michael Tweet and Phil Simplicio rounding out that Conard offense.
Phil, they ran a smash route combination there, and Flaherty missed it. Devin Pence was wide open streaking down the field, but he settled for the underneath route. The conservative play missed a potential touchdown.
Here's Richam's first handoff, tries to turn the corner, running over prospective tacklers and goes down at about the 29-yard line, very close to first down yardage. We talked about Richam, 1,446 yards, 21 touchdowns on the season. And they're going to move the chains as the first down is Richam, able to pick up about 8 on the play. First and 10 for the Chieftains out at the 30-yard line. Here's Richam again, running off the left side, turns the corner, still on his feet, 35-40, and is finally pushed out of bounds by Tyler Strickland right in front of the Hall bench. Gain of 10 on the play, another first down, it looks like, for the Chieftains.
I mean, Conard's big advantage here is their experience on both fronts. Both of their lines, a lot more experience, a lot more size, a lot more strength, and they're really getting a great push on these first few plays offensively.
First down at the 40-yard line. There's the first throw downfield by Flaherty. It's incomplete as he was trying to hook up with Devin Pence. He's the 5'10", 150-pound wide receiver. Pass was too high, and I'll stop the clock at 7:38 opening quarter, getting set for a second and 10. Again, up front for Conard. As we said, Josh Henry at center, Connor Swanton and Josh Augusto at guard. The tackles are Michael Tweet and Phil Simplicio. Here's Flaherty trying to turn the right corner, brought down at the 40-yard line with a flag down on the play. Great tackle that time, Jordan Weinstock, but again, there's a flag down on the play. And it's going to be a holding call against Conard. So will they decline it or accept it?
That's an interesting situation here. I would decline it, make it third and long, but a lot of times you see coaches want to take that extra 10 yards. I would decline it and make them pass the ball third and long. They look like they're way more successful running the ball than throwing the ball early. I would force them to complete a third and long here.
Take them out of their comfort zone a little bit and force them into the long situation. But they're going to take the penalty, and it's going to be second down and 20. Defensively for Hall, up front, it's Mike Ferengi along with Spencer Witter and Angel Rodriguez. The linebackers are Tyler Strickling, Drew Booth, Justin Searles, and Evan Duzan. In the secondary, Jordan Weinstock and Devin Richards. At the corners, the safeties are Chris Lund and Theo Blaschinski. After the penalty, second and 20 for the Chieftains at the 30-yard line. Flaherty out of the gun with two wides to either side. Single setback standing to his right. Appears to be Jones. No, it's Richem. Richem reverses his field, comes to the near side, has running room, 35 out of a tackle at the 40, and dives ahead, and Richem gets near the 42-yard line, picks up about a dozen, sets up about a third and eight.
Yeah, again, I mean, I don't know why they've even attempted to throw the ball here early. They're getting a huge surge every time they just run with Richem. It's going to be interesting here and now on this third and eight, Pete, if they stay on the ground or if they try to get it through the air.
And Chris Richem averaging 11 yards per carry on the season, pretty close to that so far. Throwing to the near side, it's complete. There's Ryan on the receiving end, and he's got the first down inside the 45 to about the 44. He beat Jordan Weinstock, who finally brought him down. Third down conversion, first down upcoming for the Chieftains.
Yeah, it's great to see both teams executing here early, Pete, and Conard is trying to respond, and the only way they can respond is with six.
From the 44-yard line, here's Richem to the near side, spun around and brought down at about the 41-yard line. Gains about three on the play. It'll set up about a second down and seven. Again, it was Jordan Weinstock leading the charge. Tyler Strickling and Drew Booth combined to finish them off on the Hall side of things for the tackle. So at the 40-yard line, it'll be second down. And a long six to the near side. Again, it's Richem. He's wrapped up and brought down. Still on his feet, though, and he spins near the 38-yard line. Good second, third effort on the play. Looked like he was going to be brought down with no gain, turned nothing into something, picked up about two or three.
That's just great balance by the senior tailback. Like you said, Pete, it looked like that was going to be a nothing run, but he spun out of the tackle and made it a very manageable third and short. It's only going to be about third and a long two here, so great opportunity for Conner to continue this drive. Thanks to Richem.
Evan Duzan on that last tackle for the Warriors. They're eating up the clock here in the first quarter, down to 5:20 to play in the opening stanza. Hall in front, 7-0, scoring on their first possession. Conard trying to answer. Flaherty takes a snap, throws to the near side. It's complete inside the 30-yard line. Ball is loose on the turf, and now they're going to say incomplete. Had it and then lost it. Was that Ryan on the near side, I believe, the intended receiver. And it's going to be fourth down. And, Chris, you talked about it on the Hall drive. It's one of those situations. They're in no man's land, and they're probably going to go for it.
Oh, there's no doubt they're going to go for it, Pete. And I would be shocked if they don't go to Richem here. I mean, it's a manageable – they're getting great surges. It's a manageable play for them.
At the 37, fourth down. They have to get to the 34. They need about three, and they actually kick it away. It's going to hit inside the 15. It's going to take a Conard roll and go dead at about the 8-yard line. So they want to pin him in deep, and that's exactly what will happen here. As with the change of possession, it'll be first and 10. Going the other way for Hall with the 7-0 lead. The timeout on the field with 4:55 to go here in the opening quarter. This is West Hartford High School football presented by the War Chief Sports Council here on WHC-TV Channel 5.
Pete, so far we've seen Hall come out, and Hall looks like the team that's favored to win this game. They've been more aggressive. They went for it on fourth down, and I'm very surprised that Conard didn't go for it on that fourth and short. You're down an early touchdown. You're at home. You're getting big yardage on the ground, and you pooch punt. It was a good punt. It was a well-executed play. We'll see what happens on this drive, but I would have gone for it there.
Yeah, I'm surprised too, Chris. Very conservative. Here's the handoff as they go off the right side across the 10 out to about 11 or the 12-yard line. And it'll be second down and long upcoming for Hall. They converted on their first drive. They went 9 plays and 50 yards in 3.5 minutes to get in the end zone here. Obviously, the much longer field to sell us on that long tackle for the Chieftains. Second down and 8. Here's the handoff again as they go straight ahead. And again, Strickland is met by the defensive front and the linebackers who combine to push him back. And he'll set up third down and long.
Yeah, 2 for 2 on this drive in terms of getting some penetration and preventing Strickland from getting that north-south momentum going. One more play to go to make me look stupid for saying they shouldn't have punted the football, Pete. So we'll see here on third and long.
See if Hall can convert here for you, Chris, and try to escape from the shadows of their own goal line. Here's Wilcox, back to pass, throws it near side, complete. He's got Wells with running room, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50, and he's finally dragged down at the 40-yard line. 48 yards from Wilcox to Wells with a lot of yak in there, the yards after catch. There is a flag down on the play at about the 40-yard line, and we'll see what happens there.
Well, where that flag is thrown, Pete, it's going to be a first down either way, but that's a great effort by Wells. I'm telling you, the two games we've seen of him so far, he's a very impressive player. He catches everything that's thrown at him, and he's tall enough to catch basically any ball over any receiver. It's going to be a block in the back from the spot of the foul, but it will be a first down, I think, as they march that off. Big conversion for Hall.
Really was. Finally brought down the combination of Reale and Ryan that time. So they'll give him the first down, as Chris said, and then they'll walk off the yards from the spot of the infraction as we have an injured Hall Warrior down at the 40-yard line. Is that Wells?
Yeah, Pete, as they were trying to catch him from behind, it was one of those violent, it wasn't quite a horse collar, but it was kind of it resembled a horse collar. He kind of got snapped down, and you know he's a tough kid, so let's hope that he's okay, because Hall is going to really struggle if they don't have their escape valve that Wells is. He allows them to alleviate all of that pressure. When teams stack the box, they know they can just spread one guy out, and that one guy is going to have a mismatch. And if he's not there, it's really going to impact their offensive game plan.
So he's limping off, but at least the good news for him, it's under his own power. And like Chris said, that definitely changes the dynamic and the complexion of the Hall offensive attack. So the penalty occurred at the Hall 39. They walked off the 10, so back to the 29-yard line. So in essence, it was a 17-yard advance and a third down conversion for the Warriors. In this opening quarter, very, very good in terms of their third and fourth down conversions here this afternoon. 3:41 to go here in the opening quarter when play resumes. It'll be first down and 10 for the Warriors. As they look to add to their 7-0 lead. Blaschinski now in the game as one of the tailbacks. Now he goes in motion to the right, and he'll take the toss from Wilcox. Here's Blaschinski at the 30, 35, 40, and he powers his way across the 45 out near the 48-yard line. Gain of about 19 on the play and a first down. So Blaschinski would come in averaging about 6 yards per carry, 8 touchdowns on the season. There's a big play out to the 48, Chris.
Yeah, that was a well-designed play. You get Blaschinski in space, which is the critical component there, is getting him in space where he could be successful.
And now they throw into the flat to the near side, and he is walloped and brought down at the 50-yard line. Big hit on the play by Byron Jones. Short pickup, gain of about a deuce, and it'll be second down and 8.
Yeah, it was a really nice job by Iverson, actually, I think, who came in there to make that play. He collared him down and threw him for no gain. Just after we saw Blaschinski's shiftiness, that time Iverson wasn't going to give him a chance in the open field.
Second down and 8. Ball right at midfield. 2 wides to either side. Now the handoff going right. And with room across the 45 down to the 43. Jaden Shaw is first carry of the afternoon. And he's close to the first down. He's going to be stopped short. It's going to be third down and very short for the Warriors. Second time this afternoon that they operate on the Conard side of the field at the 44-yard line. Lee made the last stop.
I've been really impressed with the offensive game plan of Hall here. The plays that they scripted going into this game, they've left everything out there, and so far everything's working.
Third and short, trying second, and they're going to be thrown down for a loss in the backfield. The line had the run key that time to Sellis, the first one in the backfield to throw Strickling for the loss, and it'll be fourth down for the Warriors.
I mean, that was just a great effort by DeSellis to blow that play up. I mean, that's what you're looking for in these games, individual efforts to make great team plays, and he's keeping Conard in the game now. They needed that stop, and you got to think Hall's probably going to punt here as they lost significant yardage on that play.
Back to the Conard 47. They have to get down to the 42, and that's exactly what they're going to do as they bring Spencer Witter on the field, averaging 36.9 yards per boot this year. Witter looks to the far sideline, takes the snap, boots it away, good high end-over-end kick, angled to the far side, hits at the 11-yard line, it's going to go into the end zone for a touchback, and they'll bring it back out to the 20 first down and 10 with 78 seconds to go here in the opening quarter. Hall leading by the count of 7-0. Other coaches with major honors this week, the late George Beaudry inducted into the Connecticut Coaches Hall of Fame during ceremonies Thursday at the Aqua Turf. Beaudry coached the Chieflains in wrestling to 5 state titles between 75 and 82. They have a shrine of him today at McKee Stadium tonight. Bill Condon goes into the Connecticut chapter of the U.S. Lacrosse Hall of Fame. Congratulations to them both. Here's the first down handoff. Here's Richem turning the right corner. 40, 45, and finally pushed out of bounds by Blaschinski. Gain of about 27. There's the explosiveness of Richem, who averages almost a dozen yards per carry. He doubled that right there. So Conard looking to move. First down and 10 at the 48-yard line. They go with trips to the left side. Richem stands to the left of the quarterback, Flaherty. Hand off again to Richem, and this time he's met in the backfield and thrown for a loss back at the 45-yard line. There's Spencer Witter, who had that good punt. He gets in on the defensive play that time, and it'll be second down and long.
That was a nice, like he's very close to breaking a big one. He had a nice run on first down, but Witter was there to make a nice play off of the defensive line to keep his team as. We're almost done with the first quarter here. It's a quick quarter.
There's a throw to the left side, and the diving attempt is incomplete at the 49-yard line. And it'll be third down upcoming. Clock is stopped with 39 seconds to go here in the opening quarter. So the ball spotted. So it's going to be third down and a dozen for the Warriors. Two wides to the left, single wide out to the near side. Richem standing to the left of Flaherty. Straight drop, back to pass. Throws a deep left side, and the pass is caught. First down and more. 35-30, down to the 27-yard line. Beautiful pitch and catch that time, as it looks like Ryan made the catch that time. First down at the Hall 28-yard line. So first down, here's Richem to the left, 25, 20, still on his feet, cuts back at the 15 and dives ahead near the 10-yard line. Great moves that time by Richem as they get into the red zone, and it'll be another first down for the Conard Chieftains. Two big runs on this drive here, Chris, for Richem.
Richem.
First down carry. Richem again tries to go straight ahead. Varengia leading the defensive charge that time to bring him down. And that's the way the first quarter will end. So 12 minutes in the books here. The 59th renewal of the Battle of West Hartford. And your score at the end of one, Hall 7, Conard nothing. Back with second quarter action right after this. You're watching West Hartford High School Sports on WHC-TV Channel 5 is presented by And we welcome you back to McKee Stadium here in West Hartford. Pete Lamoureux along with Chris Grace. Jen Evans leading our fine crew, including Meredith West on site, doing a nice job as always. Diana Chin as well. So here we go. Second quarter. As Richem, the lone man in the backfield, three wide to the far side. Flaherty swings it out right side, and now the running back wants to throw into the end zone. It's caught for the touchdown. They threw it to Jones. Jones threw it into the end zone, and they score, and Conard on the board for the first time this afternoon.
Rivalry games, gadget plays, Pete. You leave it all out there when you're playing against your... for on those trick plays, just what Conard needed with that trips formation, a little trick play, and they're an extra point away from tying this game.
And here's Cahill with the boot, and it is good, and we're tied after just 6 seconds of the second quarter. So again, that went Flaherty to Jones to Jack Ryan, his eighth touchdown reception of the year. Right there by booting the PAT that ties the game at 7. We were talking before about the late George Beaudry going into the Connecticut Coaches Hall of Fame on Thursday, and again tonight Bill Condon is being inducted in the Connecticut chapter of the U.S. Lacrosse Hall of Fame. Condon marked his 300th career win earlier this year, as he also coached freshman football here from 1988 to 2000. Warriors 7. 6 seconds gone by here in the second quarter. And again, 95% chance that Conard will qualify for the postseason with a win here this afternoon. Looking to continue their season, Chris, which would be a quarterfinal matchup in Class LL on December 1st.
Yeah, I mean, it's all on the line here for Conard. You said rivalry games, but when you combine the fact that you're playing against a school inside of your own town with the fact that a playoff berth is on the line with a team with a ton of upperclassmen, I mean, Conard has everything to gain, everything to lose, and everything to gain in this game. I mean, it's one of those great situations.
Cahill, a good boot, angled far side, fielded at the at the 20-yard line. Jaden Shaw was off to the races down the far sideline that time. And it looked like that return by the Lions against the Packers on the opening play of the second half last week. Almost going the distance, not quite. Great field position for the Warriors.
Yeah, same guy made the tackle, the turf monster. He's always there, and he was there right, you know, the field. By Shaw, and you got to think, I mean, this is a great environment. This is the first Hall Conard game I've done, but you know that you've got the clear contrast between the blue and red, and you see it, and you see the blue rise for a big play for Hall, and you see the red sink down or vice versa, and now Hall trying to fight back after Conard landed their first big blow of the game, and now Hall.
Booth to the near side. Single wide out to the far side. Pump fake, throwing left corner of the end zone. The pass incomplete by Wilcox. Deep left corner, incomplete, and it'll be second down.
I'm not sure who the intended receiver was.
Weinstock was the intended receiver. Big news for the Hall offense. No Wells out there after that injury. Can't spot him from this level. Handoff on the play to Strickland, but we've got the false start. The procedure penalty will back up the Warriors. 5 yards back to the 11, and that'll be second down. Weinstock's going to line up to the far side. Booth to the near side. On a second down and goal at the 11-yard line. Ferenczi also in a slot left. Strickland is the running back.
But if those first two plays are an indication, like we said, Hall's going to be in a little bit of trouble because Wells is the difference maker. He's the guy that's 6'3", can leap, and has shown great hands. And in these situations, that's where you notice it more than ever. So for them to be successful here, they're going to have to hope that Wells is okay, or they're going to have to adjust their game plan because it's clear that the other receivers
throws to his left, it's incomplete. Tended for Blashinski, who was in the area down there. It goes awry, and it'll set up a fourth down and goal at the 11-yard line.
That's tough, Pete. You know, you get a great return, you're inside the 6-yard line, and you don't run the ball.
Would be a 28-yard boot. Here's Wilcox. Back to pass. Throws end zone. Incomplete, but a flag down on the play. So this may extend the drive. Pass was intended for Big Ferenczi that time. And perhaps somebody...
But it's going to be first and goal from about the 3-yard line.
So it extends the drive for the Warriors. Now they have... Coverage was terrific. It was intended for Spencer Witter that time. Broken up by the Chieftains, and they'll turn it over on downs.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Pete, just looking back at that play, that's a critical call that it was holding and not pass interference. Because in high school and in college, they had to go for it, and that time they couldn't connect. All passing plays down there, all unsuccessful for Hall.
What a shame for the Warriors after that 55-yard return. And then it was extended by the penalty. Jaden Shaw had that terrific...
opportunity to assert themselves in this game and take advantage of the opportunity they just got.
Second down from across the 10-yard line. Again, it's Richmond with running room at the 30. Foot race down the sideline. The 50 may go at the 40.
Bring those safeties up. When you've got a burner like Richmond, a talented all-conference senior running back who's been through the battles, you bring that safety up. If he misses, that's what's going to happen. And Richmond made them pay, taking it all the way to the house.
.38 mark here in the second quarter. The War Chief Sports Council would like to thank our many fine sponsors, including those at the varsity level. Low Tide Photography, Dave Newman Photography, Cork and Bottle, Blue Plate, thanks to one and all from the War Chief Sports Council, making broadcasts like today possible. So, Chris Grace, a lot of fireworks in this game. Great touchdowns, razzle-dazzles, great returns. We've seen it all, and we've seen only about 13 minutes of action.
Yeah, I mean, it's been all it's cracked up to be, Pete. You gotta love these types of games. When there's a slight favorite like this, the underdog's going to leave it all out there. And that's what we've seen from Hall, being very aggressive. And Conard withstood those punches. They withstood that. And now is an opportunity for them to build off of that Richmond run, to get a stop on defense and really assert themselves as the better team, which on paper they are. But as you know, in these rivalry games, it normally doesn't come down to the better team on paper. It comes down to the team that executes better on that day.
Weinstock and Shaw back deep for the Warriors as Cahill has it teed up at the 40-yard line. As you might imagine, another big crowd on hand for this one here this afternoon. Years past have had better than 5,000 in some of these games. And they're going to call for the fair catch at the 33-yard line. Evan Duzan makes the fair catch, and Hall pretty good field position as they'll get set to put it in play. First down and 10, their third possession of the afternoon.
Yeah, you know, I see over there on the sidelines, I see Wells with his hands on his hips, which tells me that for right now, he's a no-go, which is a big, big problem for Hall. If you make them one-dimensional, Conard can stop the run. If you don't have an outside threat, it's going to be tough for Hall to move the football. So whatever tricks they have up their sleeves, now would be a great time to bring them out without their senior wideout on the field.
So they'll start at their own 32-yard line as Wilcox brings the team on the field. Drew Booth will line up to the near side. Strickland is the running back. Three wides to the far side. Play action, fake, they throw it. Far side intercepted at the 25 and down to the 20-yard line. As Iverson comes up and makes a huge play defensively for Conard, and the Chieftains are in business after the turnover, first and 10 near the red zone.
The senior Bobby Iverson was ready for that one. He jumped in front of the bubble screens. We talk about this all the time. Those screens, doesn't seem like the risk reward is there. And when they don't work, they become disastrous, either losses of yardage or turnovers. And now Conard's in a position to really put the pressure on the Warriors.
So he picked it at the 30, gets 9 yards on the return. And the Chieftains will have it first down and 10 at the 21-yard line. So now all of a sudden, that Hall defense really under the gun, and really a huge stop before Conard opens up a two-touchdown lead. Flaherty on the keeper tries to go off to the right side. Little running room. Ferengi had the initial penetration that brought him down after a gain of about one on the play. 57, Evan Duzan on that last stop. No gain on the play. It'll be second down and 10.
Yeah, Conard really needs to convert on this opportunity.
Low snap, handoff, straight ahead with running room. There's Richmond dancing in and out of tackles, and he goes down near the goal line with a first down and goal to go. Richmond with a terrific round that time. Lund made the touchdown saving stop for the Warriors. First down and goal. They spot it just inside the 5-yard line. There's Richem, tries to run to his right, but he's going to be dragged down. Brandon Beecher along with Spencer Witter combined on the stop. It'll be second down and goal.
Conard's hustling to the line of scrimmage. They want to go tempo, no huddle, not give Hall an opportunity to make substitutions or to react to what they're doing here in this red zone possession.
Second and goal at the 4-yard line. Flaherty hands off to Richem, tries to go to his left, and he swarmed under and brought down for a loss. That Warrior defense led by Witter. He had help from Theo Polishinski as well, and Angel Rodriguez came there, and it'll be third down and long. Big play for the Hall D.
That was a huge play by Witter. Now what he did is he made this a very likely passing situation, which helps his defense out on the third and goal.
That'll take place from just inside the 10-yard line. Flaherty with an audible. He's actually looking to the near sideline. Backs up back into the gun with Richam to his left. Two wides to the near side. Play action fake. Flaherty still has it. Throws middle, incomplete. Threw into double coverage that time. And the pass goes awry. And an interesting call here. Cahill, who's 7 of 9 on field goal attempts. This would be a makeable 27-yarder, and he's coming onto the field.
That was a great job by Witter. You know, on that drive, Witter basically put his defense on his back. Witter drilled Flaherty as he was releasing that ball. And if he gave him just a little bit longer, he might have had time to connect with his with Ryan going across the middle on that slant. Great job by Witter of keeping Hall in this ball game as they attempt the field goal now.
Cahill, 7 of 9 on the season. 31 is as long. This will be a 27-yard attempt from just inside the far hash. Good snap. Ball placed down. Plenty of leg on the way. It's high enough, and it is good. 8th field goal of the season for Cahill. And at the 8:45 mark here in the second quarter, a double-digit advantage for Conard. With the score, the Chieftains 17 and the Warriors 7. This is West Hartford High School football on WHC-TV Channel 5, as presented by the War Chief Sports Council.
Pete, that was a great opportunity for Conard to really take control of the game. They were up 14-7. Richam with an explosive play coming off of that turnover. They're right on the verge of the end zone, and Witter single-handedly kept Hall in the football game. I genuinely believe if Conard scores there, it would be a near impossible task without Wells for Hall to come back. But he held him to a field goal. There's 8:45 left in this first half, and Hall has plenty of time to try to respond. But the bigger problem for Hall is going to be, where do they go for offense? Because it looks like the Conard defensive front is really focusing in on Strickling. If they do that, someone else is going to have to step up, whether it's Blashinsky or Witter. Someone's going to have to take Wells' place on the outside and make some plays, because they're going to struggle running the football against an 8-9-man box from Conard.
So getting set for the kickoff. Before the kickoff, the War Chief Sports Council would like to thank our many fine sponsors, including those at the All-State level, Keating Insurance Agency, Macca Plumbing and Heating, Reed and Reach PC Counselors at Law, ESPN, the Conard and Hall PTO, and Mr. and Mrs. Jonathan Gibson. Thanks to one and all for your continued patronage. End over end kick, it's short. It's going to be fielded inside the 30, and the return out to about the 35. Graham on the return, gets about 5 on the run back, and it'll be first and 10 for Hall out at the 35-yard line. So both teams having their defenses rise to the occasion with both red zone stops. Hall not scoring their last possession, and Conard being held to 3 in their last time with the ball. And a big drive right here for Hall to get something going. That's 17 unanswered for Conard here, Chris.
You know, I hate to be repetitive, but we talk about it in these rivalry games, so much of it is based on momentum. And as long as you're having success, the underdog can carry that momentum. But when they got stopped on that fourth down play, it really seemed to shift the mo in this game. And right now they're trying to find some back.
So at the 36-yard line, the two wides to either side. Here's a handoff, goes to Shaw, and he gets to about the 40-yard line. He was the motion man going from right to left. Took the handoff from Wilcox and gained about 4 on the play. Iverson made the stop for the Chieftains, and it'll be 2nd and 6 upcoming at the 40.
Yeah, I like what Hall's doing. You can't overreact and just force balls down the field. I mean, you got to run the ball. They showed some success on the opening drive running the ball. Don't go away from the running game. Use the clock as your ally and try to establish the run.
Little razzle-dazzle, here's Blashinsky, wants to throw, has a man open. Oh, it's incomplete at the 27-yard line. Pass was intended for Jordan Weinstock, who was behind the defense that time, just a little too long.
Yeah, Pete, I just called for it, right? We asked for them to pull whatever they had out, whether it's a trick play. They ran a reverse pass. Blashinsky clearly isn't a quarterback, as that pass was wobbling a little bit, but Weinstock was wide open. That was the type of play they needed to get back in this game, and they missed a golden opportunity.
So it's 3rd down and 6 at the 40-yard line. Witter and Booth to the near side. Two wideouts to the far side. Strickland Hasn't touched the ball in a while. Remains the setback. Back to pass. The rush is on. Throwing left side. Caught and a first down and more across the 50 down to the 45-yard line. Blaschinski on the receiving end. A huge play right there. Almost picked off. Ray Alley thought that he had a beat on it, but not until a 15-yard completion and a first down.
Yeah, Wilcox needed all 6'3" of his frame to be able to stay on his feet there, and he did a great job of withstanding the pressure, somehow throwing a catchable ball, and Blaschinski did the rest. Great momentum builder for Hall there as they are marching into Conard territory.
And they have it there for the third time this afternoon, first and 10 at the 45. Hand off to Strickland. Tries to go straight ahead and does not even get back to the original line of scrimmage. Number 50 leading the charge, Zach Bohm that time. He's a 5'10", 190-pound senior, and he was able to plug the hole. Loss of two, it'll be second and a dozen.
Yeah, you know, after that first drive, Conard has really made a concerted effort to take Strickling out of the game. They're in the backfield every time he touches the ball. It's going to be interesting to see if Hall makes that next adjustment. And clearly they know they have some openings on the outside if they can complete the passes. But so far they've really been unable to get the big play down the field.
Blaschinski lining up in a slot to the far side. On second down, 11, here's Strickling. Crosses the 45, dives ahead to about the 43. Picked up about three on the play before he was brought down by Steven Bentz. Made the stop, and it'll be third down and long. Another obvious passing situation for the Warriors, who did convert earlier on this drive on a previous third down opportunity. Clock running inside of 7 minutes to play. Ball spotted at the Conard 43. They have to get right to the 35 in order to move the chains and extend the drive. Witter and Booth to the near side. Ferengia and Blaschinski to the far side. Third and 8 at the 43. Straight drop for Wilcox. Has time. Throws it deep down the middle. Intended for Blaschinski. He's got it with a flag down inside the 25. Penning the flag. It'll be a first down at the 21-yard line. Big conversion on the play and a gain of 22.
I'll tell you, I don't know if Wilcox and Blaschinski have magnets, because that's two plays in a row where it looked like Blaschinski had no idea where the ball was and just kind of landed in his arms. And the flag is going to be a pass interference as the defensive back got there first. They'll decline this one. It's going to be a first down for Hall. But another, we talked about it. Someone had to step up for Wells, and it looks like that's the adjustment they made. Take Blaschinski out of the backfield, move him out into space as a wide receiver, and he's going to be their go-to guy if Wells can't go for the rest of the game.
Fourth time that they've converted on either a third or fourth down. Personal foul for the face mask. What if it were a... Huh. Or a face mask, they'd be tacking it on to the end of the play. Okay. So that'll move it from about the 22 or 21, just outside the 10-yard line, about the 11. So 23 yards on the pickup, add another 11, turns into a 34-yard play for the Warriors, and once again in the red zone, Chris.
Yeah, I mean, this is a critical set of plays right here. They've got to score. They've got to take full advantage of this red zone opportunity. They had five chances on the last time they were down here, unsuccessful. Now they've got to punch the football in. Whatever you got, you break it out now. You've got to make this a 17-14 game if you can and try to hold it there going into the half.
Midway, yeah. Could be another trick play with the tight formation. And the handoff goes very little. If anything, gains about a yard or two. There's Shaw that time. Brought down by Bentz, and it'll be second down and long as they tried to test the left side of that Conard defensive front behind the right side of the Hall offensive front.
Yeah, you know, that time they went double wing and they tried to hide Strickling behind and show a little trickery, but it ended up just being a wing back reverse. The defense was ready for it. There was no one spread out, so they didn't have to respect the pass, and they were ready to stop the run there.
Second down. Again, just outside the 11-yard line. Pitch to Blaschinski, left side, at the 10-yard line, at the 5, and he's going to be brought down near the goal line. So Blaschinski running powerfully to his left that time. Ray Alley with the stop to save a touchdown momentarily for the Chieftains, but it looks like it's going to be first down and goal to go.
Again, we've said it again. Blaschinski's got to be the guy. You got to get him in space, and they're doing a nice job on this drive of getting him in space. He did a nice job getting to the edge. They're going to have first and goal from very short, the one or two.
After a drive that began back at their 35-yard line. Here's a straight ahead handoff in the end zone. Touchdown Strickling, and the Warriors are in at the 5:14 mark, and just like that, pending the point, it's 17-13 as we pass the midway point of the second quarter, and finally Hall breaks the 17-0 run by Conard.
Yeah, you've got to be really, really impressed with the way that Hall responded on that drive. Without their best player, in my opinion, in Wells, they marched down the field, converting big third down after big third down. Blashinsky was critical. Wilcox did a nice job showing poise in the pocket that entire drive. And then Strickling finishes it off with the one-yard plunge. Hall is an extra point away from being just 3 points away in what has been just as advertised, this Hall-Conard game. Back and forth, very competitive and very entertaining to the neutral.
So here's Erin Bellucci on, trying for her second consecutive PAT. She's 26 of 34 on the season. Burke Martindale, one of the backup QBs, will put the ball down. Erin, of course, the kicker, former soccer player. Dad Harry, the head coach at Hartford Public. Timeout on the field before the PAT. Again, it comes with 5:14 to play here in the first half before the extra point. That'll try to bring the Warriors back to within three. The War Chief Sports Council would like to thank our many fine sponsors, including those at the captain's level, Hartford Distributors, Franklin Fine Beers, Cork and Bottle, the Bay Ruth Organization, Coastal Tool, and at the all-conference level, Allied Printing, and the Hartford Golf Club. Thanks to one and all from the War Chief Sports Council for your patronage for making games like these possible on WHC-TV and Channel 5. Great time last week at the tailgate party, and Chris, it was a lot of fun, raising almost $11,000 last week at the West Hartford Town Hall Auditorium. Really was good to see. War Chief Sports Council does so many fine things, not just the broadcast, they supply uniforms, equipment, all kinds of opportunities for all the student athletes, those who can't play sports that otherwise wouldn't be able to play, that can play. And it's really, really a worthwhile endeavor started by Paul McConnell and Dennis Swanton, and they do a great job year in and year out, game in and game out.
Yeah, you've got to give them a lot of credit for being the cog in this whole operation, getting this whole thing going, and now they're up to attempt the extra point.
So here's Bellucci on. Martindale puts it down. Kick has plenty of leg, and it is good. So again, 5:14 to play in the opening half, and the deficit down to three. Conard 17, Hall 14 here on WHC TV Channel 5.
All right, Pete, we've seen Hall start the game off hot, score on their first drive, and then Conard responded with a goal line stand, and then they scored 17 unanswered. Now Hall has responded with their best drive of the game. And for Conard, before the halftime break, they have 5:14. They don't have to rush on this drive. Stick to their guns. Run the football with Richem. Be methodical. They're getting the ball back to start the second half. If they can find a way to put three, and more importantly, 7 points on the board, they'll put themselves in a great position going into the second half.
So Spencer Witter has it teed up at the 40-yard line. Small and Jones back deep. Short kick, fielded at about the 36-yard line. It's LeGoy on the return. Gets to the far side and crosses the 40-yard line and finally is pushed out of bounds at about the 42-yard line right in front of the Hall bench. So very good field position as Jaden Shaw made the stop on the return. It'll be first down and 10 for Conard and the offense. Very interesting to see what head coach Matt Sasmo has dialed up on this drive. He's had a good combination working of running and passing, but really it's the running of Richard that's really turned this game around.
Yeah, you know what else? We haven't really seen much of Flaherty. I would look for Flaherty to get more involved here on this drive, maybe using Richmond as a little bit of a decoy, pulling those read options and taking it himself.
And he's going to throw to Jones at the 40, 45, 50 into Hall territory. and goes out of bounds at the 49-yard line. Gains about 8. Richards on the stop for Hall. It's going to be a second down and short. You talked about Flaherty getting into the offense. Ran for 5 touchdowns, threw for another, had 280 total yards in the victory over Newington a week ago. Second and a long one at the Hall 49-yard line. Here's Richam running right, first down and more, crosses the 45, brought down at about the 43-yard line. Gains about a half dozen, first down, Conard.
You know, both of those first two plays look the same. The subtle difference is that's a play that drives the defensive coordinator crazy because it's a read option that could also be a pass. The first time he pulled it and threw it outside on the quick screen, that time he handed it off to Richam.
Drew Booth on the last stop leads the Warriors in tackles as 63 coming in. First down and 10. Richam runs to his left inside the 40. Flag down on the play as he carries tacklers inside the 35. Down to about the 32. Drew Booth on the bottom of the pile made the stop that time for the Warriors. But we'll wait for the football from the Zebras.
Yeah, you know, I think this one might, at first it looked like it had to be a hold, but there might even be 2 fouls. Nope, it's just going to be a hold against Conard. Hold against Conard, that's going to move him back, and Pete, that's not a good time for that penalty. You take away a big run, and you now put it yourself in a situation where the clock might become a factor here with 4:07 left to play in terms of just exclusively running the football.
Yeah, it changes the whole dynamic of your offensive approach, that's for sure. 10 yards from the spot of the infraction. The run had gotten down inside the 32, and they're going to bring it out to the 42-yard line. So they get first down over again. It's going to be first down and about 8 at the Hall 42-yard line. As Flaherty and Richam both look to the near sideline for instructions from the coaching staff. 3 wides to the far side, 1 to the near side. Pump faking, throwing deep left side, has a man wide open, it's caught inside the 10 to the 5, touchdown, Devin Pence on the receiving end, the senior on senior day gets into the end zone at 3:45 to play, and it's 23-14, beautiful pump fake that time by Flaherty, and he's able to toss his 14th TD pass of the year.
You know, earlier in this game I pointed out they ran a similar play and Flaherty settled for the underneath route. That time he pump faked the underneath route and Pence was wide open. And the only thing he had to make sure he did was catch the ball and not trip over the turf. Did both of those things, a walk-in touchdown, and Conard has reasserted themselves with the extra point good. They lead 24-14 with 3:45 left to go.
And they match their biggest lead of the afternoon at 10 to make it 24-14, just past the 2/3 point of this second quarter. We talked earlier about the Class LL football point rankings in which Conard came in 7th and the top 8 qualified. Conard has better than a 95% chance of making it with a win today. Shelton is number 1, Southington 2, Darien 3, Newtown is 4, then 5 through 8, Glastonbury, Ridgefield, Conard, and Staples. They're all trying to vie for the quarterfinals, which will take place on December 1st. And a 7-2 matchup right now would have a rematch between Conard and Southington taking place. But a lot to happen between now and Thanksgiving, and then the official rankings will come out the day after Thanksgiving. The pairings and everything will be announced as 8 teams qualify in each of the 4 classes.
I would really love to know where they come up with the formula for these rankings, because on the surface it leaves a lot to be desired, but the big picture is I don't see anyone in these rankings that has more than 2 losses. So for Conard, you would think 8-2 would be enough to get him in. I mean, they're competing with teams that have 3 and 4 losses, so you got to think that's going to put them in a pretty good spot if they win this game.
Yeah, you would think. I mean, most likely win and they're in. I think there's 1 possible scenario. I didn't do the mathematical computations, but we'll see what happens. It'll all be sorted out on the Friday after Thanksgiving. Fair catch is called for by Burke Martindale, backup quarterback and the holder. And Hall will have it, first down and 10. Right around the 30-yard line for the Warriors. And Hall has won this rivalry game four consecutive years. You have to go back to 2010 when a John Esposito-led Conard Chieftains team went into Chalmers Stadium and won 41-0. John, of course, on his way at that point to 4 years at Princeton, playing football and baseball. One of the best running backs in the history of the Conard program, and they have not won a game against Hall since. First and 10, just outside the 30. Here's Wilcox with a handoff to Strickland. Tries to go off left tackle. Gets about a half a yard on the play. And it's going to be second down and long. Leading the defensive charge that time, Zach Reed for the Conard Chieftains.
Yeah, this is another really big drive for Hall with just 3.5 minutes and counting in the first half and not getting the ball to start the second half. They need to get something out of this drive.
Two wides to either side. Strickland to the left with the quarterback, Wilcox. Straight drop, back to pass, looks to the near side, and his pass goes incomplete. Intended for Blaschinski, made a diving effort for it at about the 35-yard line. It goes awry, and it'll be a third down and long. Typical scenario that Hall's been pretty successful. They converted two third downs on their last drive, and they'll have to do so here in order to maintain possession of the ball from their own 31-yard line.
If you look to the far side of the screen, John Wells is back in the game. I figured it would only be a matter of time for a senior. You don't want to miss out on something like this. If you could walk or stand, you're probably going to play, and that's the case for number 8.
Third and long. Conard showing blitz. Rolling to his left as Wilcox steps up, throws it deep down the left side. It's incomplete. Wells was the intended receiver. It was a case where Wilcox perhaps was just throwing the ball away at that time, and it'll be fourth down in an obvious punting situation.
Yeah, Pete, that was a shot play. It was going to be a double move by Wells, and he just couldn't get a clean release. Therefore, he could never really get the break on the football. It was a smart decision by the quarterback to just throw the ball where no one could catch it, and now they're going to have to punt, I think.
Operative phrase saying, I think, is you never know in this game. Witter, a nice high booming punt. Fair catch, asked for at the 35-yard line. It was made by Jones. Kick on the play of 34 yards on that punt. No return. It'll be first and 10 for the Chieftains with a second under 3 minutes to play here in the opening half.
Okay, Pete, I mean, we said going into the game that Conard should be considered the favorites, but in a game like this, right now, they kind of control the game. I mean, they literally control the game, but these next 3 minutes, if Conard were to drive down the field and score a touchdown, the game is nearly out of reach. It's not out of reach, but it's nearly out of reach. However, if they were to turn the ball over or somehow give Hall a scenario where they could only be trailing by three, so there's a lot that goes into this last drive before the half here for Conard.
Three wides to the far side. They fake it to the left side, and Flaherty on the keeper tries to turn the corner, but a good job to make the tackle at the 35-yard line. Number 2, Jordan Weinstock, came up from his defensive back position to make the stop that time. It'll be second down and about 10 yards to go. John Lagoy among those to line up to the near side. Two wides to either side. Straight drop for Flaherty. Wants to throw right side, and it's complete at the 49-yard line. Ryan made the catch right near midfield, and he's got the first down.
Tell you, we haven't seen Flaherty throw too much, but that was an impressive throw. That was about a 20-yard out. I mean, he threw it on a line, and a very nice catch by Ryan. So far, so good for Flaherty to Ryan.
Ryan's 30th catch of the year. Here's Flaherty rolling to his right, and the throw is incomplete. Heavy pressure that time by the Warriors, as a couple of players thought that they had him in the backfield, and it'll be second down and 10. Duzan's been all over the field defensively for the Warriors here in the first half. Second down and 10. Ball right at midfield with 2:21 to go. And Conard asked for and received a timeout. An injury timeout as the Hall Warriors, Spencer Witter on the far side of the field, is being attended to. The War Chief Sports Council would like to thank our many fine sponsors, including those at the varsity level. Low Tide Photography, Cork and Bottle, The Blue Plate, Fast Eddie, West Hartford Youth Basketball, the West Hartford Boys Travel Basketball Team, Low Tide Photography, Dave Newman Photography, Open Arm Christian Ministries, Final Cut Barbershop, Edward Connors Insurance, Stanley and Elaine Phillips, Beth Barry Brown of the William Ravis Agency, and the West Hartford Girls Lacrosse League. Thanks to one and all for your patronage of the War Chief Sports Council. Spencer Witter, certainly an invaluable member of this team, wide receiver, defensive back, also plays some defensive end as well, and averages about 37 yards a boot as their punter. Second and 10 from midfield and a straight drop for Flaherty. Throws it to the near side, incomplete. His receiver fell down. That was John Lagoy, the intended receiver. And it'll be third down and long.
Yeah, he had him, but Lagoy couldn't keep his footing and was unable to connect with Flaherty that time. It's going to be an interesting call here on this third and long. You don't want to give the ball back to Hall with too much time, but you also want to try to put yourself in the best situation to move the chains. Interesting to see if they go run or pass here on third and long.
At the 50-yard line. Straight drop for Flaherty. Back to pass. Throws it, and it's caught at the 30. There's Lagoy, far side. He's going to score. 15, 10, 5, touchdown. John Lagoy gets it at the 206 mark, the 50-yard touchdown pass, and it's 30 to 14, Connor.
Boy, I'll tell you what, when that pass was thrown, I thought it was going to be picked off, but Lagoy won the battle, and there's one surprise player today. It's got to be Lagoy. I mean, he stood out. We haven't noticed him up until this point, but he's made a couple of big-time plays and looks to be a threat there. 6'3", breaking down the field. Nice play for Connor as they stretch this lead. Huge play.
And Cahill's conversion on the way, and it is good. So a big one right there for the Chieftains. They go up 31 to 14, a 17-point advantage with 2:06 to go. And we talked about the big advantage on the other side that John Wells has with the height. And there's the height advantage, not so much on this play, but we've seen it on other plays for Lagoy, certainly making his presence felt, Chris, in that opening half.
Yeah, you know, you talk about it. It's all about those little things. Who makes the big plays? We saw two teams who have both had equal opportunities, but Conard has made all the critical plays. When Conard ran a trick play, they completed the double pass. When Hall ran the trick play, they just missed on the double pass. When Conard's had third and longs, they've made big-time catches. Hall have made some big plays, but not enough to cancel out the talent level and the experience level and the size that Conard brings to the table. And you have to say that Conard is probably deserving of this 31-14 lead at the half. Or, excuse me, with 2 minutes left in the first half.
They can really put the points up on the board in a hurry. Three times this year they've scored 50-plus. They come off the 58 that they scored last week at Newington. And they're on pace for a 62-point performance if they can duplicate in the second half what they've done so far here in the first half. And when they got their first touchdown earlier, they became the highest single-season scoring team in Conard history. Kickoff to the near side is going to go out of bounds. It's a break for the Warriors, give them outstanding field position. And like you said, Chris, here's not only are you down 17, but you're not getting the ball first to start the third quarter. So that puts double pressure on you. Get a touchdown here, you're still back to within 10.
You know what's interesting here, Pete, is they're going to make them re-kick. And although it seems on the surface like that'd be great field position, that would be their worst field position of the game, I think, on a kickoff. They had the long return. They recovered the onside kick attempt on the first play.
Except for the last possession where they
right,
the 30-yard
right, correct. So they're going to make him. They've shown, although Cahill is great with the short kicks, he doesn't have the biggest legs. So they're going to make him kick it off again and try to break another big return, which I think is the right call here.
Shaw had that big return earlier, as you said, brought down by the turf monster, negating what would have been a touchdown. Here's another question for you. We had all that rain Thursday into Friday, heavy rain. We've seen three or four kids slip and slide all over the place on this field, which they didn't obviously cover. Still some lingering residual effects here today with some wet spots on that turf.
That's definitely possible, but a lot of times with the actual turf, it's just flukiness when you trip. You can't really control it.
Short kick fielded by a lineman. Look at him go inside the 50 down to the 47-yard line. That was Kyle Conlon, the 310-pound junior lineman. And he gives credence to what Chris was talking about, better field position. They're able to gain 13 yards on that.
I'll tell you, I saw enough right there. He's going in at fullback in the second half, and I'm giving him carries. I'm being 100% serious. That's one way to break down a defense. He showed great burst. I mean, he didn't waste any time. He went north, south, looked strong running the football. Get that boy in there. I'm all about the big boys getting some love. Give him some love. Put him back in there.
Well, he certainly helps his team to a short field, first and 10 at the 47-yard line. And there he goes in at right guard on the offensive line. Two wides either side. Halftime adjustment. Here's Strickland. He's got running room for the first time in a long time as he drags a tackler inside the 40. Finally brought down by Steven Bintz. Good pickup. It'll be second down and short for the Warriors. Clock running inside 1:45 to play here in the opening half. Second and two at the 39-yard line. Blaschinski in a slot to the right. Two wides to either side as Strickland remains the tailback. Back to pass is Wilcox. He throws. It's complete. He's got Wells and a first down across the 35 to about the 33-yard line. We'll stop the clock to move the chains. Gain of a half dozen on the play. First and 10.
Wells is a difference maker out there. I mean, you put the ball within a three-foot radius of him, he's going to make the play. We've seen it in both times we've covered them, play after play. Three touchdowns versus Southington. Big difference maker for the Hall offense. They've missed him in the first half.
And he lines up far to the left side. Throw is tipped at the line of scrimmage intended for Blaschinski, and it goes incomplete. It'll be second and 10. The only good news for Hall is it stops the clock with a 1:12 to go here in the opening half.
Gives the offense a chance to catch their breath here as this is a critical, critical drive. I mean, they have got to find the end zone here as they'll be kicking off to start the second half, and they trail by 17 right now with 1:12 left in the second quarter.
Wells and Verengia to the left. Blaschinski to the near side along with Weinstock. Back to pass. Throwing a deep ball down the left sideline, and it's incomplete. Closer to the ball was the intended, away from the intended receiver, the defensive back in coverage. That's out to knock it away, and it'll be third down and 10. As back in coverage, stride for side, Carson Reale that time, giving away about 6 inches to Verengia, but the pass was nowhere near him.
It's really a great job by Reale, positioning his body between himself and the sideline and using the sideline as an extra defender. That's what you're taught as a defensive back. He did a great job forcing a third and long.
At the 32-yard line with two wides to either side. Hand off to Strickling. Tries to go straight ahead. Crosses the 30 down to about the 27-yard line. And I think Hall has thought they're going to ask for a timeout. This is fourth down at the 27-yard line. And now the timeout taken. Comes with 56 and a half seconds to play here in the opening half before the fourth down at about 5.
You know, Pete, that's an interesting situation there. I don't disagree with calling the timeout. I don't know if I would have called it right away, though, because now if you don't get this fourth down, you give Conard with a full allotment of timeouts an opportunity to maybe march one more drive down the field. With that said, you've got to get together and pick out the best play you have in the arsenal as they trail by 17 points. I maybe would have let it run for another 10 seconds or so before I called that timeout. But that's nitpicking, and here you've got to think they're going to try to find a way to get some space for Wells on one side of the field and isolate him in a one-on-one situation. To do that, you might see a trips on one side and Wells lined up on the other side, and they're going to just try to high point the football to Wells and utilize all 6 foot 3 inches and great leaping ability that the senior wide receiver has. Hall really has no other option but to score here. They're down 31-14. There's 55 seconds left in the first half, and they're kicking off to start the second half. It's a rivalry game. They score here, anything can happen. They don't score here, they could be in a lot of trouble for the second half.
Be interesting to see if Wells is double covered, whether Verengia also at 6'4" is an option. Wells lines up far to the far side. Two wides to either side. Wilcox takes the snap, throws over the middle. It's incomplete. Threw it behind Varengia. And turning it over on downs, it'll be first and 10 for Conard with 52 seconds to go here in the opening half.
Yeah, you know, Wilcox has made a lot of good plays in this half. That time he got happy feet and he got rid of the ball too early. Varengia wasn't ready for it, hadn't turned around yet, and he didn't have any pressure. He could have taken some time and let that develop a little bit, but he was worried on the fourth down. He got rid of it quickly, and unfortunately for him, his tight end wasn't ready to catch the football, and that's a critical miss there as Hall has turned the ball over. Now, like I said, Conard's going to have the ball with enough time if they choose to try to add to this lead.
52 seconds to go. First down and 10 for the Chieftains. Just across their 25-yard line. Straight drop for Flaherty. Pump faking. Deep right side. Downfield intercepted inside the 45. Down to the 40-yard line. There's Shaw picking it off that time. They had single coverage deep down the right side. The pass was underthrown. Shaw with good coverage that time, picks it off, and it'll be first and 10 the other way.
Yeah, that's not what you want to do when you're getting the ball back before second half here. They're going to extend the first half by a couple of minutes and give Hall yet another opportunity here. I tell you, when you throw that ball, you've got to make sure. And Shaw was 4 or 5 feet behind his receiver. There's no way that was going to be successful. Bad decision by Flaherty there. And Hall has another chance now to try to score before the half.
At the 40-yard line, 45 seconds to go as they get set for the first down and 10. Weinstock to the near side. Leshinsky in a near slot, two wide to the far side. Back to pass as Wilcox, the rush is on and he goes down inside the 30, back at the 28-yard line. 55, Connor Swanton leading the charge that time. Big loss, second down and long upcoming.
Yeah, that was a great play by Swanton, and that's just what Connor needed there. It seems now as though Hall's probably not going to push it here. Maybe take a shot, throw the ball down the field to Wells, but with just 15 seconds left, they might just take it to halftime.
So that brings a smile to the face of our friend Dennis Swanton as Connor gets the sack right there. Lobbing to the near side with a flag down, incomplete. It was intended for Weinstock. And it looks like a defensive holding call against Connor.
I'll tell you what. I don't know what's going on over there. There's 5 seconds left. You can't make a mistake. Take it to the half. You're up by 17 points. Another ill-advised mistake by Connor. And now Hall's going to have another opportunity with 4.8 seconds left as they march off this yardage. I didn't see much there, but they clearly called some form of illegal contact or holding. With 4.8 seconds left, I don't think he has enough arm to get down the field, but they're going to have a chance to get in the vicinity of the red zone.
From the 41-yard line. So as Chris said, just under 5 seconds to play here in the opening half. Chieftains actually have three defenders back standing near the 30-yard line. They're about 30 yards behind the line of scrimmage. Throwing it deep down, intended for Blaschinski, and the pass is almost intercepted. It goes to the turf. Back in coverage was Small, and that'll do it for the opening half. So the Warriors, who had jumped out to a 7-0 lead, saw Conard come back with 17 unanswered, and eventually that is their lead at halftime. 24 minutes in the books here at McKee Stadium, and the score in the 58th renewal of the Battle of West Hartford, Conard 31, Hall 14. We'll come back with first half impressions later in the intermission. You're watching West Hartford High School Sports on WHC-TV Channel 5 as presented by the War Chief Sports Council.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the 50-50 raffle ticket winner. Check this thumb tap number is 729-844. 7298444. If you hold that ticket, please bring it to the press box.
Patty Foot. Okay, I'm going to ride it phonetically, okay, hon? Matt Petchen. Okay, could we do them now, or do you want to wait? Do you want to wait? It's up to you, Meredith. Okay, is that okay, guys? What's that? No, you're gonna do it from here. We just need to change the batteries. How long have you practiced it? How long? Okay. Oh, okay. Great. Is something you want to do for a little? So what we're going to do, when she goes back to the battery, I'm just going to give a brief introduction to you. You want to sit here? Thank you.
Good. The attendant says that the Conard Future Cheerleaders takes the field.
I'll start us off in about 30 seconds, okay?
Don't you open up that window. Don't you let out that antidote. Them pills is all we know. Inhales is all we know. Don't go through the front door. It's low key at the night show. So don't you open up that window. Open up that window. Open up that window. Open up that window. Open up that window.
We're still awaiting the winner of the 50-50 raffle. One more time, check your tickets for the winning number of 729-844. 729-844.
Stadium or at halftime. Conard is in front of Hall by the count of 31-14. The Warner Chief Sports Council is happy to incorporate student sportscasters into the broadcast. We have two students here this afternoon, one from each school, to give reports on the fall sports season. So with a look at Conard, here's Kate Pettyfoot.
And has recognized more than 300 wins. He will be inducted this season into the national high school lacrosse association.
For the Conard High School volleyball team about their record and why it was so low. It was 5-13. She said, "I believe the record was so low because by the time we started working together as a team, the season was halfway over. The teamwork wasn't there when we really needed it, and we gave up too early in our matches. By the time we all learned how to play together as a team, it was too late. Every team has at least one tough season. When I asked Carrie Roller, who's a varsity coach, about their team this year, she said, this year was a rebuilding year. We had a lot of new kids to the varsity level. Next year, this team is sure to thrive, seeing as though they will be hungry for the wins. Unfortunately, I was unable to talk with Gwen Geisler, who finished 10th place, or Lindsay Chen, who finished 22nd place for the Class AA meet for cross-country four girls. The girls finished their season with 2-3. With that, Taylor Davis has recently signed with Wagner College for track and field. A big congrats to her from everyone at Conard. Also, congrats to Marissa Haverty for signing to Assumption College. She'll be playing both lacrosse and will sim for them as well. Boys cross country had a challenging season this year with an 0-6 record. I was unable to meet with anyone to ask them questions, but next year they are sure to have a turnaround. Sam Nanny was able to finish 40th in the class double LC meet. The boys soccer team was 8-10, and although I was unable to interview players and coaches, they had a great season with amazing turnouts from our fan section. I got to talk to two juniors on a field hockey team who did exceptionally well this season, Catherine Bland and Lauren Kumpa. Lauren said, "I'm just so proud of how far we have come considering that just a few years ago, girls coming onto the team hadn't even heard of the sport. Even seeing the change in level of play from my freshman year is incredible. I just hope we can live up to the expectations for seasons to come." Catherine said, "Our record this year in the regular season was 15 wins and one loss, which represents a lot of what we've done as a program the last couple of years. It was really rewarding to have all of our hard work pay off and be able to get as far as semifinals, because that is something the program as a whole has been working towards each year. I couldn't have been happier with the team and the way we played this season. Congrats to these ladies and their team. They sure have come a long way and couldn't be prouder." Girls soccer had a great season as well with a record of 8-8 and made the second round of states. When I asked a few juniors on the team, Maggie Murray and Maya Feigenbaum, how they thought their season went, they said, "We had a lot of fun and played better than previous years. We could have worked on our attitude more and off the field." Well, these ladies surely managed to have a great season. On behalf of Coleman, who was also supposed to be here but couldn't be here, he interviewed a few guys from the football team. The football team this year had a record of 7-2. He asked Stephen Vince, a junior linebacker, what's it like to be a part of a winning Conard football team? Stephen said, "Feels great, like all the lifting and off-season work is really paying off." Stephen attributes the winning season to a mix of great coaching preparation, superb talent, but mainly great leadership from captains Bobby Iverson, Jack Ryan, and Nate Richum. Coleman also asked Nate Richum, as a three-year starter and leader on the team, what legacy do you want to leave with the Conard Chiefs and fans? Nate said, "It's not about me and it was never about me, but it was about the team and the winning tradition we left and the culture of success that we built for the next generations of Conard football to come." Pretty humble words from a guy with 22 touchdowns and 1,450 yards this year. Coleman also asked Henry Fisher, a junior receiver, what does the Hall/Conard rivalry mean to you? Henry said, "Very long tradition that has a lot of history. It creates a playoff atmosphere and gives us a certain sense of pride in meeting anytime you can win a Hall/Conard game. It can make or break a season, but this year is different because we want to make our mark on Hall, but also look forward to larger goals as a team."
Great job, Kay. Thank you very much. And from Hall, it's Matt Petchen to talk about what the Warriors did in the fall season for their sports.
Good afternoon. Today I'll be your Hall High reporter, Matt Petchen. Boys soccer, led by sophomores Maxwell Drazen and John Punt, made a magnificent run in the State Cup, making it all the way to the semifinals, suffering a heartbreaking 2-1 loss to Glastonbury. Our last-minute goal was a phenomenal shot by junior defender Eli Perry. Girls soccer also lost a well-fought game to Ridgefield 3-2 in the quarterfinals. A profuse amount of excitement and pride has been going around the halls as Hall's own golf star Chris Butler just recently signed a letter of intent to play at Boston College. The swimming and diving team continues their outstanding season as the All-State junior captain Tara Tiernan leads the way for Hall today at Yale for the state open. Volleyball made states as well, unfortunately losing to Fairfield Ludlow 3-0 in the first round. In addition to all these amazing state cup runs and a letter of intent, boys cross country placed 4th overall in the Class L tournament as the girls cross country acquires a new coach in Mr. Scott Sampietro, as field hockey hires a new coach of their own, Kat Hanks. Our high school finished off yet another successful fall sports season with great potential for our winter and spring teams. Thank you.
All right, thanks very much. As we had our student commentators here at halftime, about a half minute before we get set for play in the second half. Chris Grace joining us again for the broadcast, and take us inside both locker rooms, Christopher. What are these coaches saying to their respective teams as we get set for the final 24 minutes of the 2015 regular season?
Well, Pete, thank you, first of all. I think for Conard, it's pretty simple. Stay the course, keep it simple, don't make mistakes, run the football, take advantage of your senior bell cow running back, and don't overcomplicate things. For Hall, it's all guns blazing. It's leave it all out there. There is no tomorrow. You're a 5-win football team. This is your chance to leave your mark on the Hall football program. If you're a senior, you leave it all out there. If you're a coach, you throw the kitchen sink at them. And you have plenty of time. I mean, 17 points, although it seems like a lot, There have been many a game where a team has been up by 17 points and they've blown that lead in the second half. So for Hall, you go out there, why not? I wouldn't be surprised to see some sort of an onside kick or some sort of a trick play early for Hall to try to gain some momentum. But really, what do you have to lose? You're down 31-14. There is no tomorrow. I mean, there literally is a tomorrow, but not for Hall football. So they have to go out there and leave it all out there and go get them. We take a moment here to acknowledge the seniors, both the players and cheerleaders for the Hall and Conard football teams. For Hall, it's a much shorter list. We have Amari Bartley, Aaron Bellucci, Gianmarco Cianuve, Giovanni Garcia, Jack Kanaga, Austin Kerr, Harrison Newman, Angel Rodriguez, Tyler Strickling, Jordan Weinstock, John Wells, Matthew Wilcox, and Jacob Zedoff. For Conard seniors, Joshua Augusto, Cassian Banks, Zachary Baum, Kiernan Boyd, Thomas Callahan, Tyler Carson, Grayson Carter, Jessen Sherian, Lucas DeCellis, Jordan Dorfman, Ian Gertie, Tori Green, Elijah Hales, Joshua Henry, Robert Iverson, Byron Jones Jr., Nicholas Cranmis, Jonathan Lee, Matthew Lee, Kyle Pena Green, Devin Pence, Carson Rialli, Zachary Reed, Nate Richem, Jack Ryan, Phil Simplicio, Saquon Small, Connor Swatton, and Michael Tweet. And the Conard cheerleaders, Narumi Alicia Collins, Brittany Gator, Dejan Johnson, Monica Kareem, Daniela Mendez, Crystal Rodriguez, Segway Small, Allison Volpe, Madison Woods, Jenny Yanyan, and Desiree Goff. Real quick, with 30 seconds left, let's give you the scoring summary, how we ended up here. Hall opened up the scoring with 8:33 left in the first quarter on a 12-yard catch by John Wells on the pass from Wilcox to go up 7-0, extra point good from Bellucci. Conard did not score in the first quarter, but they opened up the second quarter. First play of the second quarter, Flaherty threw it out to Jones, who then threw it to Ryan, a double pass for a touchdown, extra point good, 7 apiece. Richem then with an 86-yard scamper doubled the lead to 14-7. A 27-yard Cahill field goal with 8:45 left made it 17-7. Strickling responded with a 1-yard touchdown plunge to make it 17-14 with 5:14 left in the half. Then Flaherty hit Pence on a 40-yard pump and go to make it 24-14. And with 2:06 left, LeGoy beat his defender and went 50 yards to the house, extra point good. 31-14 is the score as we get ready to start the second half here at McKee Stadium. Conard leads in-house, in-town rival Hall by a score of 31-14. And here to bring you all of the action for the second half is the incomparable Pete Lamoureux.
All right, Chris, thank you. As both teams still on the field, be interesting to see all of those halftime adjustments. While we're taking care of some business here, we'd like to tell you that the War Chief Sports Council would like to thank its sponsors and supporters for making last week's tailgate fundraiser an enormous success. Tailgate netting over $10,000, which will in turn be used to benefit student athletes at both Hall and Conard. The War Chief Sports Council, a booster club supporting all athletic teams at both West Hartford High Schools. For more information, please visit war-chief.net. That's war-chief.net. Paul McConnell, Dennis Swanton work tirelessly to help build the cause, so please offer your support when you can. Thanks to all involved with the broadcast today, Meredith West and Diana Chin here on site. Thank you for your terrific work. Jen Evans, always the one constant back at the studio here on WHC-TV Channel 5. Anytime you get together for this rivalry game, I have a great opportunity to talk to all of the coaching staffs, especially the head coaches, Matt Sersosimo, Frank Robinson, both very gracious with their time this week, as well as historians of both schools, Steve Blanchfield at Hall, Ed Lytus Jr. at Conard. that supply us with all the facts and figures for this game. They know more than anybody in terms of West Hartford football, and those guys can go at it and talk about it, and brings a lot of interesting perspective to this game as well. 59th renewal, as we're waiting for the captains to meet with the officials here at midfield. Conard again, 7-2 on the season with the victory. Almost always would cinch a Class LL quarterfinal playoff berth. They would play again on December the 1st, and what's at it in terms of what's at stake for Hall, trying to finish above the 500 mark at 6-4 if they can pull out miraculous comeback in the second half and get the victory, and would also extend their personal winning streak over Conard to 5 consecutive years. Good, nice crowd gathered here today. We've had as many as 5,000 in attendance in years past. Probably don't have that mark here today, but certainly a big throng on hand here at McKee Stadium for the climax of the 2015 regular football season.
Well, Pete, this is supposed to be a day game, but something tells me the floodlights will be on before this one ends, much to the demise of some of our colleagues, but that's okay. We got lots of game left there at half field, going through the rituals like you would see pregame. I believe it's because Conard deferred in the first half, so they had the option again, and you have to go through the process. But nonetheless, it's been a start and stop afternoon after a very quick first quarter, and we've got just 24 minutes of game time left to go, and to determine not only who will win this heated in-town rivalry game, but to determine if Conard will be one of the 8 schools in Class LL that will continue their season by making the state quarterfinals. So a lot to be played for here at McKee Stadium, and it is all on the field from here on out.
And these teams have had postseason bursts in their past. The recent past, not so successful, as in particular both teams in the 2010 campaign losing their opening round encounters. But hey, Conard trying to change things with a victory here today and try to advance to the quarterfinals. But as they go forward, certainly a big loss for them. Jordan Dorfman, who had almost 1,000 total yards from scrimmage this year, broke his leg in the game against Newington in the victory by 4 touchdowns a week ago. And certainly his presence will be missed as this team goes forward. So here's Spencer Witter getting set to tee the ball up at the 40-yard line. Combination of Byron Jones and Saquon Small back deep for the Chieftains, as we're just about ready to go to resume play. Low line drive kick's going to be fielded at the 37-yard line. They get ahead across the 40 out to the 42-yard line. And it'll be first down and 10 upcoming for the Chieftains, as Drew Booth made the stop on special teams right there for Hall. Interesting approach here, Chris, in the second half. See if Conard comes out all guns a-blazing or whether they're going to be content to try to work the clock a little bit and be content with the fact that they're 17 points in front.
Well, Pete, the thing is, I think they could do both, because for Conard to be most successful, it goes through Richmond. And by going through Richmond, you keep the clock moving. You get the ball in the hands of your best offensive player, and you keep the clock moving by running the football. I think that's what they need to do, and probably what they will do.
And here's Richmond with the first down carry. Good power running across the 45 out near the 48-yard line. Pickup of 7 on the play. It'll be second down and 3 upcoming. Talked about Richmond coming into this game, 1,446 yards, 21 touchdowns, an 11.4 average. He gets the carry again. Stutter steps, comes to the right, has first down yardage and more, crosses into Hall territory, across the 45, down to the 41. Gain for a dozen and a first down. Booth made the tackle that time for the Warriors. So, 2 carries, total of 17 yards, and it's first down for the Chieftains on the Hall side of the field. Again, it's Richmond going to his right. He's at the 35. He's at the 30. And he powers over would-be tacklers inside the 30 down to about the 27-yard line. You know, he's an electrifying performer, Chris, but he's a good power runner at times as well.
Yeah, he really is the total package. I mean, you look at him and you don't think he's as powerful as he is, but he's got a very strong lower body, and he finishes his runs, and he does a good job of using his arms, stiff arming, et cetera, to get extra after contact.
There he goes again into the secondary and finally hauled down inside the 10 with a first down and goal to go. Christian Lund among those on the stop for the Warriors. Four carries in this half, and he has almost a total of 50 yards just in the third quarter alone. And a flag down on the play. Procedure call against the Chieftains, so that'll back him up to a first down and goal from out around the 15-yard line.
You know, it's interesting, Pete, because they've run the football on every play, but they've only used up a minute and 8 seconds on the clock, with the clock stopping on first downs in high school, which is a rule I think they really should change, with the exception of the last 2 minutes in each half. It's prevented them from really eating up any of the clock on this drive, and they're playing at tempo. They're not huddling, so they're running the football at tempo, which is kind of counterproductive to trying to control the clock.
Yeah, they figured it is stay with what works for them right now. There's Richam again. And he's going to be corralled and brought down this time. That right side of the defensive front, Drew Booth among those in on the stop. Bottom of the pile was Jordan Weinstock as well. And it'll be second down from outside the 10-yard line. They're going to spot it. About the 10 and a half-yard line. And it'll be second down and goal to go. Chieftains trying to add to their 17-point advantage in their first possession here in the third quarter. Here's Flaherty, back to pass. Throws towards the end zone. It's intercepted in the end zone by the Warriors. Picked off, and a big defensive play right there by the Warriors to keep them in the periphery of the game.
Pete, I can't for the life of me come up with a good reason for why the football has left the ground. For Conard, you're up by 17 points inside the 5-yard line, inside the 10-yard line after the penalty, and you throw into double coverage. It's a terrible decision by an experienced player, and it's a questionable play call to put him in that position. And now you go from being able to really just crush Hall to they've gotten a stop, they got the ball back, and they're a touchdown away from being within 10 points of this game. I cannot believe that play.
Amari Bartley with the pick for Hall. And here's their first play from scrimmage. And there's Strickling off to the races. 40, 50, 40. Three men chasing him from behind. And he's finally hauled down inside the 30 at about the 27-yard line. So Carson made the stop. So that is a 50-plus yard run. Give him 54 yards or 52, depending on the spot. 50 yards on the advance down to the 30-yard line.
I'm telling you, Pete, in a game like this, you don't want to give a team new life, and Conard gifted Hall new life by throwing the ball there, and now Hall is marching on a route to cutting this deficit to 10 points.
Here's Strickland again, and he backs his way across the 30 down to about the 29-yard line. The illegal shift will be the flag that's down. It's assessed against Hall, and that'll back him up five back beyond the 30-yard line. So to add to your point earlier, Chris, you had Richam doing everything on the ground and had all the momentum on your side. At the very least, you're going to go up 20 and kick a field goal, the second field goal of the day for Cale. You can't go down there, get into the red zone, and not come away from points, with points. Now all of a sudden, one big play for Hall, and they're knocking on the door here. First and 15 after the penalty at about the 35-yard line. Play action fake. There's Bleszczynski on the right side at the 30, far sideline, ridden out of bounds inside the 25, down near the 23-yard line. It's a pitch and catch and good for 11 yards, and it'll be second down and short.
Nice job that time just getting the ball to Bleszczynski in space. And I'm telling you, Pete, if Hall finds a way to punch the ball in here, we've got something in front of us, because you look at this Conard sideline and you don't see a lot of energy, you don't see a lot of fire, Hall can gain the momentum right back in this football game with 6 points here.
At the 23, it's second down and three. Here's the run by Blaschinski at the 20, at the 15, and he's finally dragged down at the 10-yard line. Gain of 13, first down Hall.
Tell you what, Blaschinski has played a critical role in keeping this Warrior team in the game. I mean, not only did he make catch after catch when Wells was out, but now he's showing that added dimension of running from his slot wingback type of position. And I'll tell you, right now, it's all one-way traffic. It's all Hall so far here on this drive. So they're doing whatever they want on offense. Critical halftime adjustments made by both teams. And so far, Hall's made the better adjustments.
First down after the Blaschinski run. Here's Strickland trying to go straight ahead. He runs into a wall that time. The Chieftains stand him up and bring him down back beyond the 10-yard line.
Yeah, they tried to use Blaschinski as a decoy there as a wingback. They put him in motion, but the timing wasn't quite right, so they didn't really sell the fake, and Strickland was really left for dead there. Nowhere to run, and it's going to be a second down and 10 just outside of the 10-yard line.
Clock running. Inside of 8:15 to play here in the third quarter. Hall trying to take advantage of the interception, trying to go the long field, trying to take advantage of that long Strickland run. Here's Blaschinski trying to get to the right edge. He's at the five. He's into the end zone. Touchdown, Hall. So a combination of Strickland and Blaschinski on this drive, and the Warriors on an 80-yard touchdown drive at the 8:02 mark of the third quarter can cut it to a 10-point deficit pending the extra point.
Just a great job by Hall of staying in this football game with their backs against the wall, literally and figuratively. They find a way to get an interception and then march down the field. They go 80-plus yards. They go 80 yards literally, and it's just an impressive job by the Warriors here in the second half.
And Bellucci drills the extra point. She's 3 for 3 on the afternoon with her PATs. And with 8:02 to go here in the third, we got a ball game again. It's Conard 31, Hall 21, here on WHC-TV Channel 5 as presented by the War Chief Sports Council.
Okay, Pete, so now it's 31-21 with 8:02 left in the third quarter. Conard, their sideline, they have to get back in this game. You got to see some energy. You got to see some fire. You're playing for everything right now, not only playing against your crosstown rival, not only playing against kids that you grew up playing sports against, baseball, basketball, football, bragging rights for the whole year. You're playing to get into the playoffs. You've got a ton of seniors, 30 seniors on this Conard team. They've got to show fire. You're playing for your guys that got hurt last week. All of these things are factors, and right now I see a ton of energy from the guys wearing white, and I see a lot of heads hanging low from guys wearing red and silver, and that's got to change if Conard's going to win this football game.
So Witter getting set to boot it deep. Jones and Small back deep for the Chieftains. And again, he keeps it along the ground. It's fielded at the 38 and out at the 39-yard line as it was caught that time by Pham, and it'll be first and 10 at about the 39-yard line. So we'll see what Hall does, or Conard does, on their second possession here of the third quarter. It was all Richem all the time until they got into the red zone, and then the interception by Bartley stalling that one, and I think we'll see a steady dose of number 6 again this time.
I do too, but I'll tell you what, if I'm Hall, I'm putting 9-10 guys in there and just selling out and saying, forcing you to throw the football, because why else wouldn't you? What have you got to lose? And so far, so good in the second half for Hall. Go get it. Why not? Why not us? That's what I would say if I was on the Hall sideline.
At the 39, here's Richem. Has room. 45, 50, at the 40, at the 35. Out of a tackle at the 30. Great balance. Great perseverance. He's in the end zone. Touchdown, 61 yards. Nate Richem into the end zone for Conard. There's your Chieftain answer at the 7:50 mark. And now it's 37-21. Nate Richem, the all-everything performer for this Chieftain squad.
Yeah, I mean, again, it just brings into the why not give him the ball on every play? I mean, you just saw everything on that run. Great blocking by the front as he was untouched for the first 10 yards, but then it was all Richem, and the senior showed great power, great balance, and great burst to get away from his tackler. to extend this lead for Conard and take away that essentially the effectiveness of that last fall drive in one fell swoop.
So think about this. He's touched the ball five times, and in just 4 minutes and 10 seconds, he's gained over 100 yards here in the third quarter alone. This is a kid that's three times this year over the 200-yard mark, comes off a 239-yard performance in the victory last week over Newington, and he continues to be an electrifying runner. And you have to think, at day's end, he's going to be somewhere around the 1,700-yard mark for the season. 296. And we thank our buddy Tom Yance from the Hartford Current. If you're watching live this afternoon, you can read his coverage tomorrow in the Current. 18 carries, 296 yards. And if you do the quick math, that's over 16 yards a carry.
So, Pete, what that math tells me is that Declan Flaherty probably won't throw another pass in the second half of this game. And again, it's so intriguing because when you watch Richmond with the ball and you watch the surge this Conard offensive line gets, you wonder maybe they've outthought things a little bit here. Where else this game would already be out of reach and we'd be approaching that Cochran rule territory, because when you've got a guy who can run for 300 yards on less than 20 carries, I mean, you don't need Einstein to tell you that he should be touching the ball a lot from here on out.
Yeah, absolutely so. Very, very difficult to break down, especially in the open field. I'd like to count, we saw the 296 yards. I'd like to count the number of broken tackles that he has forced this afternoon. It's got to be 20 or 30 by now anyways. And they angle a short kick, almost an onside kick, and it's fielded at the 50-yard line. And they give the Warriors outstanding field position. 53, Brandon Beecher fielding the kick from Cahill. And they're giving the Warriors the short field.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on here. You know, that's where he clearly doesn't have a big leg. That's where you get one of the biggest guys on the team. You just have him tow it down the field. Because the 10-yard pooch kick, your team has no chance of recovering it. And it's just giving Hall great field position. I don't know what's going on with that. They've been doing it all game long. So obviously they have a strategy. It's just not working.
And they were burned one time on that Shaw return, and ever since then, they have not dared to kick the ball deep. Here's Strickland. Gains about a yard as he gets into Conard territory. And it's going to be second down and long upcoming for the Chieftains, or for the Hall Warriors, rather, at the 49-yard line. Hendricks in that last stop for the Chieftains. John Wells lined up to the near side here. See him limping a little bit noticeably as he came to line up. Pass goes to Ferengia, and he's immediately wrapped up and put down with a loss back on his side of the turf at about the 48-yard line. Fooling nobody that time as he was wrapped up and brought down. Steven Bintz made the stop, third and long.
That play doesn't make a lot of sense to me. You're running a screen to a big, slow tight end. It's going to be everything's going to have to work perfectly for that to be successful. And if you're aware of it, then the play is going to get blown up, and that's what happened. The clock continues to move as we approach the six-minute mark here in the third quarter.
Third down and 11 at the Hall 49-yard line. Twin wides to either side. Straight drop for Wilcox. The rush is on, throws on the run, and is knocked away at the 35-yard line with a flag down on the play. 83, Steven Bintz made the stop as he got back in coverage. And we'll wait for the flag.
Yeah, I think something on the secondary, you would think. Oh, no, wow, it got thrown 10 yards down the field, but it's going to be a holding call against Hall. No. I was right. It's a holding call against the defense. So it's going to be third down and about four. Actually, third down. Where are they? What is the rule on holding here in high school? I can't get it straight. I mean, it was third and 10, and they're marking it as an 8-yard penalty. I have no idea, Pete, but it's going to be third and short.
Yard line. Third down and a yard at the 41-yard line. Two wides to either side. Blaschinski is the running back to the left of the quarterback Wilcox out of the gun. Takes a snap, hand off to Theo, tries to go off right tackle, and he's going to be brought down inside the 40-yard line. Looks like he should have enough for the first down, and he does. Gain of two down to the 30.
Keeping it simple there, running the ball with Blashinsky, and that'll keep this drive going. And Hull is still well in this game. If they can force a couple turnovers and convert on this drive, they're only going to be down 10 points. So this is a critical drive for the Warriors, as everyone is from here on out.
At the 39, first down and 10. Wilcox takes the snap. Hand off to Strickland, and he's met immediately for a loss back at about the 40-yard line. Hendricks leading the charge that time for the Chieftains. He had some help from Dylan Forsberg as well.
Yeah, you know, that time they tried to use misdirection. They sent Blashinsky out like they were going to run some sort of a trick play or a screen to him. But the problem was the other nine guys stayed in the box and blew up the play, and they weren't able to get any room for Strickland to run.
Second and 11. Wilcox throwing deep downfield, incomplete with a flag down on play. Conard, 23-yard line. Small can't believe the call, but it will go against the Chieftains, and Hall will have a first down.
Yeah, again, Blashinsky showing that he's a very capable receiver coming out of the backfield, and he's made a number of big catches, and in that time he did everything he could to make the catch, but the defensive back wasn't going to let him, and that's why the flag came in. And I actually on the Conard 25-yard line with 5:19 left.
15-yard pass interference call puts Hall in business once again as they try to get into the end zone for the second time here in this third quarter and get the deficit back to a manageable 10. First and 10, straight drop for Wilcox. Back to pass. Throwing deep left towards the end zone. It's incomplete. He overthrew his intended receiver. Jordan Weinstock had a step. Be second and 10.
Yeah, that time Wilcox had both Wells and Weinstock open. He chose to go, I think, for Weinstock, but he overshot the end zone by about 5 yards, so no one was going to bring that in. But another missed opportunity for the Hall offense. There are plays to be made against this Conard defense, but Hall's got to take advantage of those opportunities, and that's a few times we've seen guys get behind the last level of defense and unable to connect with the senior quarterback.
And they got him and throw him down short of that 25-yard line. Good ankle tackle that time. 53, Lucas DeCellis was among those in on the stop. And it'll be third down upcoming as the clock runs inside of 5 minutes to play here in the third quarter.
Yeah, you got to think if Wells is out on the field, you got to get him the football. I'm not looking for anything complicated. I would look literally to throw a 10-yard, 11-yard. So this is four down territory. That might be a sign of a run play here, Pete.
Third and 10 at the 25. Wilcox back to pass. The rush is on. He drops the ball. It's loose at the 33-yard line. And it looks like that Hall was able to pounce on top of it. But in any event, it's going to be a big loss of about 9 on the play, setting up a fourth down and 19.
Yeah, they fake the wingback sweep. And Wilcox was unable to avoid the rush, and he's very fortunate that his lineman was ready and recovered that fumble, as now they'll have one more shot here to either pick up the first down or draw another penalty to prolong this drive and prolong their hopes of coming back in this football game.
38-21 Conard, 4th and 18 Hall at the Conard 33-yard line with under 3:40 to play here in the third quarter. Tied by the Chieftain straight up the middle. Lucas DeCellis, Dylan Forsberg among those in on the stop. And it'll be first down and 10.
Yeah, just a great job by the Conard team rallying after they gave up that first touchdown here in the second half. It would have been easy for them to not fight back there, but they did a great job of fighting back and regaining their authority in this game. They have completely Cougars, and UConn's taking a 7-0 first quarter lead. Wow. 7-0 Huskies early on.
In the action in East Hartford this afternoon. Richam gets out of would-be tackles and then finally powers ahead across the 45 with a flag down on the play. So it's probably going to go against the Chieftains. If it doesn't, then that means put Chris on the case as well if he can find out a score from West Haven, Connecticut, where the Yale Elis and the Harvard Crimson battling in the game. 10 yards from the spot of the infraction. I am. I'm talking about a game where there's about three times as many people as there are at East Hartford this afternoon. Trying to turn the left corner. 30, 35, 40, 45. Still on his feet as he cuts back at midfield. 45, 40. It's a foot race down the far sideline with one man to beat at the 20, the 10, the 5. He's in the end zone. Touchdown, Conard. Nate Richam, 71 yards for the
I think Mr. Richam has more than done his part this afternoon, helping out his fallen teammate. We talked about Dorfman being out, what kind of issue that would be for Conard. Well, clearly, judging by the nearly 400 yards that Richam has accounted for as the extra point goes through, Conard.
So unofficial, he has 369 yards rushing, 71 yards for the scamper. Cahill, by the way, 6-for-6 in PATs. He now has 52 points after touchdown this year. That continues to add. The Crimson lead 14-7 at Yale. I think they have. They really have. Elis had their chance. Cahill. Yeah, very good. Yeah. Yeah. Momentary stoppage on the field before Cahill gets set to kick off. War Chief Sports Council would like to thank our end kick fielded at the 32, short return as the Warriors cross the 35-yard line. Max Main and Hales on the stop on special teams will be first and 10 for Hall at the 36-yard line.
Level of experience that these two teams have, comparatively speaking. But Hall has nothing to hang their head about. They've been in this football game from an offensive perspective. They've got to just keep plugging away. Still a three-score game if they convert the two-point conversion. So you got to start with one. So let's try to pick one up here.
Throw to the near side, complete. Out to the 42, pickup of a half dozen, and it'll be second down and four. As Wilcox had an opportunity to go and confer on the far side. Second and four at 42. And a first down for the Warriors.
It's interesting, Pete. You would think that Conard would key on Bleszinski at this point, but he seems to be getting a lot of space, and it's one way that Hall could potentially get back in the game.
With the stop, first and 10 for the Warriors.
Again, Bleszinski, he is showing that he does not want this game to go by the wayside. He's leaving it all out there, and he's just a junior, so he'll be back next year to play this rivalry again, but he doesn't want to lose, so he's going to fight to
in the hole. Give him a couple on the play, and it'll be second down and eight. And Forsberg also in on that last stop.
Again, if you're going to run a play like that, the timing has to be perfect. And if you don't sell the fake on the wing reverse, then the Strickland's got
a third down and long, stops the clock with 52 seconds to play here in the third.
Yeah, again, you know, I think Wilcox is starting to get happy feet back there. He's getting rid of the ball a little too quickly. He's pulling the ball in the fakes a little too quickly. He has to be patient, trust.
Chieftains were waiting for him. Good lateral pursuit by the Conner defense that time. And it'll be fourth down and about seven at the 35-yard line. And they may just run out the third quarter clock. And that's what they're going to do. So, an outstanding. Council. Welcome back, everybody. Fourth quarter set to begin. Fourth down at the 35-yard line for Wilcox and
leaving it all out there for his team, and it's super commendable right now.
Here's Blaschinski, left side, cuts back at the 20, flag down on the play. He would have scored, but this one's coming back as he tried to dance down the far sideline. And we're just waiting for the official indication from Bob Heimgartner and his crew. And the holding call will bring it back for Hall.
Yeah, just got a little overzealous there on the outside. As a wide receiver, when you're blocking, you can't get outside the numbers. And if you do that, they're going to call you every time. Blaschinski didn't look like he needed much help. There was plenty of room out there, but now we know why there was so much room, because we saw multiple flags come flying for the holding call, taking a touchdown off the board and really putting them in a difficult situation here. As again, we must point out, Pete, they are only down by three touchdowns and 3 2-point conversions. So if they score here and get the two, it's a two-score game. So the game is not over. 11:40 left to go. Monday night miracle.
A little salt in the wound there. That's a private Jets-Dolphins exchange. Oh, he's got the socks on and everything. Ready for his battle tomorrow in the Lone Star State against Houston. See if his team can stay over 500. First down and 15. Pump fake, pass complete. There's Blaschinski, and he's going to score. 10-5 touchdown. 30 yards from Wilcox to Blaschinski. And 28 seconds into the fourth quarter at the 11:32 mark. That makes it 45-27. As Chris said, it amounts to a three-possession game. If they go for two right here, they can make it a two-possession game.
Yeah, again, Blaschinski and Wells and Wilcox, they refuse to lose right now, and they have to go for two here. I don't know if they're trying to figure this out or if they're unsure. You have got to go for two. 17 does nothing for you. 16 makes it a two-score game, and it looks like Wilcox is back out there. They are going to go for two. It's a critical play here. If they don't get this, it's going to make it percentage-wise very difficult to come back. If they do, they have plenty of time to score two touchdowns and get 2 2-point conversions.
So, Wilcox and the offense on the field. Blaschinski, a big afternoon for the Hall side. Somebody who was supposed to be de-emphasized from the Hall rushing and passing attack here this afternoon has certainly made his presence felt. Here's Wilcox looking to throw right side, intended for Varengia. It goes too far, and the two-point conversion goes awry. So it remains an 18.3 possession game with 11:32 to play here in the fourth quarter at 45-27. The War Chief Sports Council would like to thank our many fine sponsors, including those at the captain's level: Hartford Distributors, Franklin Fine Beers, Cork and Bottle, the Bay Ruth Organization, and Coastal Tool. And at the all-conference level, Allied Printing and the Hartford Golf Club. Thanks to one and all for your patronage to the War Chief Sports Council, the official sports booster clubs of both the Hall Warriors and the Conard Chieftains. So, not too early to start thinking about onsides. I think you have to go there. I think you could have kicked deep if you go 16 down. I think 18 down, you try to get yourself the ball back here with 11 and a half to go.
I mean, the bigger thing is, Pete, neither one of these teams have kicked the ball down the field on a kickoff anyway, so you might as well just really kick onside. That's the frustrating part, is that they're giving away these short kicks without giving themselves any chance of recovering it. Why not go traditional onside, line up six guys on one side of the ball, and just try to battle and get the ball back, because they cannot give the ball back to Conard right now.
So here's Rodriguez getting set to kick off. The onside goes to the left, and it's pounced on by the Chieftains at about the 48-yard line. So 24 came over to pounce on top. That's Bobby Iverson, the senior. And you know what? I think even if Iverson doesn't pounce on top, I don't think it was going to go 10 yards. It was close.
You know, I always like for the defender to make that play. Iverson didn't take any chances. He knew he could field it. It's a great senior play there, because you never know on this turf. The ball could spin funny ways, and if he lets it go and it gets to that 10 yards, then what are you going to do? You just gave him the ball. So don't take any chances. Just jump on it, and he did the right thing there.
Hand off to Richum, going to his right. Oh, he hurdles over tacklers as he goes down the far sideline, inside the 30 and out of bounds at the 27-yard line. So he turned no gain into a 23-yard advance and goes out of bounds. We've seen everything from him this afternoon.
That was pretty incredible. It looked like it was going to be a 1 or 2 yard loss. And next thing you know, he's in the air hurtling over a defender, and as he approaches the 400-yard mark for the afternoon. Incredible. And he's probably getting fairly close to Arkell Newsom's state rushing records right now in terms of individual game. I'll have to check on that.
So, yeah, at the 26-yard line. First down and 10. Here's Richum running to his left inside the 20 at the 15, and he's finally brought down near the 10-yard line. Drew Booth with a touchdown-saving tackle that time for the Warriors.
Pete, I think both of us thought that Richum was going to have a good day today. Did we think he was going to go over 4 centuries worth of yardage? Absolutely not, and it speaks to a senior leaving it all out there and trying to leave his mark and do his part with an injured backfield mate, doing it all on his own today, single-handedly.
Got it to the 13, gained 13 on that last play. Here's Richum again at the 10, at the 5. He fumbles the ball. It's loose in the end zone. And did he jump on top of it? He did. Touchdown, Richum and the Chieftains. And at the 10:52 mark, the Chieftains, for the fourth time this season, over the half-century mark, as now Richum is over a quarter of a mile running this afternoon.
It's pretty impressive stuff. Even when it goes bad, it goes good for Richum. I mean, he fumbles the ball into the end zone. There's 3 Warriors there, and it pops, and it falls perfectly right into number 6's hands. Hall extends their lead here.
And the kick by Cahill is good. And it's 52-27 after the 7th PAT in succession this afternoon by Cahill. Injured Warrior down on the play as they tried to block the extra point. Is that Shaw on the field? Yeah. He's sitting at about the 10-yard line. So he hurdles over guys. He fumbles and recovers his own fumbles in the end zone. I mean, what else can the kid do this afternoon to establish and further accentuate his greatness?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty surreal right now when you think about it. I mean, it kind of happened out of nowhere, too. I mean, he was having a good game, but what he's done in the second half has taken it to next-level proportions. I mean, we've dropped Esposito multiple times during this game. Esposito never had a game like this. He never had a game where he ran for over 400 yards. Very few in the history. You're talking about guys like Tim Washington, Arkell Newsom, some of the best players that have gone on to play Division I football out of the state of Connecticut, let alone in a rivalry game against your inner-city rival. It's really been an impressive performance. And with 10:52 left, only Coach Sersosimo can determine how many yards Richum's going to end up with. He could go over 500 if they want to.
I'm thinking back to the 70s. I'm going to date myself. John Pagliaro, the fine running back out of Derby. Rich Angelone at Lyman Hall. The great Rich Diana, who went on to play 2 years for the Miami Dolphins, take the money and run to med school. They all had outstanding days back in the 70s, but nothing like we're seeing from Mr. Richum here this afternoon. So they're almost double them up on the scoreboard, 52-27 with 10:52 to go here in the fourth. As Cahill will get set to boot it.
Weinstock and Blaschinski
back deep. So that means Jaden Shaw, who's the injured Warrior on that last in-vain attempt to block the extra point, is not back deep for the first time this afternoon for the Warriors. Angle to the near side. Goes through the hands of Trevon Graham and goes out of bounds.
See, what I don't understand is if you kick the ball out of bounds, right, the ball's going to come out to the 40-yard line in high school. Is that correct? So why wouldn't they just do that every play and just kick the ball deep and out of bounds as opposed to the little 8-yard pooch kick that they've been kicking directly to the front line of Hall all day? They need to figure that out between now and the state playoffs if they do make the state playoffs. Because you can't give a good football team, not to take anything away from Hall, you can't give a playoff level, a Southington, a Shelton, the types of teams that they will be playing, the ball on the 50-yard line every play. So they're going to have to address this moving forward, are the Chieftains.
So at 35, the Warriors have it first down and 10. Chris talking about the hierarchy in Class LL. Shelton, Southington, and Darien, the top three, and one of those the likely opponent for the Chieftains if they qualify for the playoffs a week from Tuesday, December 1st. Pump fake by Wilcox, throwing a deep ball left side, wide open at the 40-yard line is Weinstock. He cuts back to the middle of the field, still dancing inside the 30, down to the 29-yard line. Gain of 36 on the play and a first down.
Yeah, not a great job by the secondary there. It was actually Lucas DeCellis who came all the way from the line of scrimmage at his linebacker position and tracked that play down to bring down Weinstock. But again, lack of focus from this Conard defense. They've got to alleviate some of these mistakes moving forward because you can't just let a team hang around and hang around. You've got to be more disciplined on the defensive side of the football.
It's a good point as they go forward. Strickland, plenty of room at the 20 to the 15 and down at the 14-yard line. Finally wrapped up and put down, 16-yard advance and another first down. So give the Warriors credit. They don't quit whatsoever. They spotted at the 15, and it'll be first down and 10.
Not a lot of defensive highlights so far in this game.
Yeah. If you had the under, you're certainly long been in trouble. Lob towards Wells in the end zone. It goes incomplete. Stops the clock at 10:03 to play here in the fourth quarter.
You know, the only thing I could think of is with the concern over concussions, maybe they've alleviated tackling during their practices or alleviated tackling as they come up because, I mean, you're seeing gaping holes on both sides of the field. As good as some of the plays have been, as probably as poor as some of the defensive technique has been here in the second half.
Second down and 10 at the 15-yard line. Strickling to the left of the quarterback, Wilcox. Two wides to either side. Throwing left corner of the end zone, nobody there, and a flag down on the play. And this will extend the drive and get them inside the 10-yard line.
Well, the officials clearly have late dinner reservations tonight as that ball was no less than 30 yards overthrown, but they called holding and not PI, so it's not technically uncatchable on a holding call. So they'll get some extra yardage, and it'll be third and short from just outside of the 5-yard line.
So third down, ball spotted on the far hash. Actually, yeah, they got the down back, so it's second and 2 at about the 7-yard line. Blaschinski in motion, takes the handoff, comes to the near side, at the 5, tries to get towards the pylon, he's in, touchdown Hall. Theo Blaschinski, who's having a terrific second half in his own right, maybe not the numbers that Richmond has, but he's in the end zone again. And pending the conversion, it's 52-34 at the 9:52 mark.
Yeah, you know, that was very similar to the last Blaschinski touchdown run. He got the ball out to the perimeter, and then the Conard defense doesn't have the impression like they really want to be out on the field. Pretty weak tackling on that drive, just to call a spade there, Pete. I mean, they marched down the field untouched in a rivalry game. That's not over yet. It's an 18-point game. If they get a 2-point conversion here, oh, no, there's one extra point on the scoreboard. It's a 19-point game, isn't it?
It's 52-33, so they added an extra point. And here's the kick by Bellucci. It's good. Now it's 52-34, so still a three-possession game with 9:52 to go.
Yeah, that's a mistake. They should have gone for two there. Making it 18 does nothing for you, but making it 17 makes it two touchdowns and a field goal.
Right.
But, again, we're nitpicking here. We're certainly not coaches, so we're not going to make those type of decisions. But for Hall, again, I mean, 34 points. Many chances to tuck their head inside their shell and hide, but they've been bold turtles here this afternoon. They're not afraid of the moment, and you got to really commend and respect this Hall team. They're obviously rebuilding, a lot of youth, a lot of inexperience, but the guys who are out there fighting, they'll be able to sleep well tonight because they've really, really played hard throughout the entirety of this game, especially on the offensive side of the ball.
Yeah, we've talked time and time again about the experience disparity on the two squads. 30 seniors for Conner, just 10 for the Hall Warriors. So keep in mind the personal foul penalty will be assessed here on the kickoff. So instead of kicking on their own 40, Hall will be kicking off at the Conner 45-yard line. So Rodriguez will get set for presumably another onside kick. And the lights have come on here after 4 o'clock on this Saturday afternoon. Here's the onsider to the near side, and it's fielded by the Chieftains, and here they come. Stabnik off to the races, and he's going to score. Aiden Stabnik, a 6-foot, 190-pound sophomore, 63 yards. Fielded it at the 37 and went 63 yards. And they have matched their season high with 58 points. They can go for the 59th right here with Cahill. Unbelievable.
I don't even, honestly, Pete, I mean, we could be looking at 100 points here if they want to. Neither one of these teams has made a tackle in what feels like an hour. This second half has looked like it's looked like a midget football game in terms of the tackling and the space that these guys have and the follies out there. I cannot believe it. Someone's got to go out there and lay some lumber into somebody. 10 minutes almost still left in the game. Unbelievable.
Cahill with the extra point. And at 9:42 to play in the game, 59-34, Conner. The War Chief Sports Council would like to thank the many fine sponsors, including those at the all-state level, Keating Insurance, MACA Plumbing and Heating, Reed and Reege PC Counselors at Law, ESPN, Conard and Hall PTO, and Mr. and Mrs. Jonathan Gibson. Thanks to one and all for your continued support of the War Chief Sports Council, benefiting both Hall and Conard. So, 93 points on the board. One more touchdown and one more conversion to go to hit the century mark. And what has been, certainly has to be classified as the wildest of the 59 battles that started back in 1957. And they've had some tremendous battles over the years, but nothing that quite looks like this.
Yeah, this has got to be driving the defensive coaches for both of these teams absolutely nuts. As much as you can appreciate and respect some of the individual efforts that both teams have had offensively, the core of the game of football is to tackle and to prevent the other team from scoring. And when you look up at the scoreboard and with almost a whole quarter left to play, and you see 59-34 in a rivalry game, it's just not the football that I grew up. It seems ridiculous to me. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to demean the offensive performances, but.
There's a kickoff by Cahill. Blaschinski runs up to catch it, crosses the 35 and out to the 37. Carson and Reale on the stop. And it'll be first and 10 for the Warriors out across the 35-yard line. So if you go back, was it 31-14 at the half? Was that what we had at the half? So 28-20 in 14 minutes. So we've got 48 points in 14 minutes of play here in the second half. Seven touchdowns. A touchdown every 2 minutes. Continue to just pile up the points.
It speaks to the unnecessary nature of stopping the clock after first downs throughout the entirety of the game. I'd like for that to be there for the conclusion of the game, in the conclusion of the half, but you don't need that for the entirety of the half.
First and 10, here's Strickland, met at the line of scrimmage and thrown back at about the 35-yard line. Dylan Forsberg and Owen Hendricks combining on the stop. And it'll be second down and 10. John Wells to the far side. Two wides to either side. Play action fake. They put it in the hands of Blaschinski. Runs to his left. Spins out of a tackle as he crosses the 40 out to about the 42. Picks up about 7 on the play. It'll be third down and 3.
Yeah. Down by 25 speaks to why they needed to go for 2 there, Pete, on the previous possession. Because now they're down by 4 scores no matter what they do. So it's 4 down territory. If they would have gone for 2 and gotten it, they'd be down 24 or 16 relative to the score if they hadn't given up that touchdown, obviously, on the onside kick.
Third down and 3 for the Warriors at the 43-yard line. Here's Wilcox. Back to pass. Throwing deep left side. It's incomplete. Well over the head of the intended receiver, Blaschinski. And it'll be fourth down, stopping the clock at 8:26 to play here in the fourth quarter. Irison back in coverage for the Chieftains. So again, keep in mind that the official pairings will come out on Friday, but we'll know all the numbers on Thanksgiving Day. And if you go to the CIAC website, or you pick up your Hartford Current on Friday morning, you'll know how everything is shaken out. Fourth down at the 43. Wilcox looking to the far side for guidance from the coaches. Throws far side. He's got Blaschinski, and they have the first down across the 45 at the 47-yard line.
Well, that was another – I mean, we've seen on a number of fourth down plays that Wilcox has converted, and Blaschinski – and Wells and Wilcox, for that matter, have all really fought valiantly here this afternoon.
Yeah, give Paul all the credit in the world. Certainly a valiant effort. No quit in them whatsoever. And while they'll come out most presumably on the short end of the stick, certainly Frank Robinson and the coaching staff have to be pleased with the resiliency. Deep ball right side, looking for Weinstock. He's got it. He runs underneath it and makes the catch at the 28-yard line. 25 on the advance and a first down.
Very impressive play by Weinstock. Add him to the list. He's made some nice plays too. That was a tough catch. The hardest catch to make for a receiver is over your right shoulder. It's almost like a blind spot, and you just see the ball right as it appears. He made a beautiful catch and almost kept his feet in play where he could have taken it up the sideline for a touchdown. Either way, big play for the Warriors.
And they get to the 28-yard line of the Chieftains with a first and 10. Yeah. Two wides to either side. That's Strickland to the left of Wilcox. A pass to Blaschinski, left side at the 25. Brought down from behind at about the 23-yard line. Gains about 5 on the play. Irison brought him down on the far side. Reale was also there on the stop as well. And it'll be second down and 5. I would think, Chris, you sense a little more urgency here. Okay, you're down 25. I understand that. But, again, you don't want to totally, totally quit. And not that they're quitting, but, again, I would go as much hurry up as I possibly can.
I would counter that by saying that Conard has scored on almost every play they've run in the second half. So there's a point where yes, but I think after those last two onside kicks, they probably are going to approach differently. I typically would agree with you, but here I'm not really sure if they need to.
And the pass is incomplete, looking for Wells. And it'll be third down and about 5 at the 23-yard line. Yeah, we talked about all the points from Conard. We talked about all the yards from Richmond. Also, we're going to go over the three-hour mark pretty soon in this contest here this afternoon. Third and five at the 23-yard line. Here's Wilcox, back to pass. Throws deep wide side, Ferengia, wide open, touchdown! Mike Ferengia, the 6'4", 228-pound junior on the receiving end of that toss from Wilcox from 23 yards out, and the Warriors hit the 40 mark. It's 59-40 with 7:01 to go.
Wow, so that was a nicely designed play. They ran a pick play and got him wide open in the corner of the end zone, a nicely thrown ball. And again, they should be going for two here, but they're kicking the extra point to make it an 18-point game.
At 59-41 with 7:01 to go in the contest. You know, back in the mid-90s, I had the great pleasure of being the voice of the Connecticut Coyotes, and when Tony Terzi and I went to do a year of games and Joe Linta, the NFL agent who represents 28 players, did the second year, I think we only had three arena games that went over 100 points in the 2 years that we did. So it is an offensive game of epic proportions here this afternoon. Hall Warriors on the far side of the field, huddling up as they get set for another opportunity, presumably to kick it 10 yards, or maybe they'll just concede that fact and kick it deep. Who knows?
I would say you got to, I mean, at this point, like you pointed out before, 7 minutes is plenty of time, especially in this game. You got to, again, I don't know that they don't have a better chance trying to kick it around the 25, 30-yard line of recovering it than the traditional onside kick, though, because they clearly aren't disciplined when it comes to recovering onside kicks or coming close.
And it's fielded by the Chieftains on the far side of the field at about the 49-yard line. So it'll be first down and 10 for Conard at that spot. Again, the War Chief Sports Council throwing the thanks out to those at the captain's level supporting group, Hartford Distributors, Franklin Fine Beers, Cork and Bottle, the Babe Ruth Organization, and Coastal Tool, and in the All-Conference, Allied Printing, and Hartford Golf Club. Here's Flaherty after the fake to Richem. Fumbles the ball, and Hall's got it at the 46-yard line. Are you kidding me? And here come the Warriors with 6:53 to go in the contest. Second turnover in the second half by Conard. They had one interception in the end zone, and now they had the fumble here.
Pete, I don't know whether to laugh or to cry. I mean, you've got a guy that has 400 yards. If you want to salt the game away, give it to number six. What is the dilemma here? The guy hasn't been touched the entire game. I have nothing. I have nothing for you, Pete.
First and 10 at the 45. Wilcox near side. Has Ferengia. He's at midfield, and he puts his head down and gets into Conard territory at the 49. Gains six, and it'll be second down and four. So Mike Ferengia, the nephew of the head softball coach for Conard, Tom, making his presence felt here in the second half. Second and four at the Chieftain 49. Looked like movement along the defensive front. Looked like Nick Kramus crossed the line of scrimmage. And 5 yards. We'll move it down to the Conard 44. We'll set up a third down and one.
I, for one, can't wait to read the wrap-up in tomorrow's Hartford Current, because let me tell you, there is so much involved in this game. To try to get it into one capsule or one story is going to be very difficult. But you got to think, there's going to be a lot of offense involved in that story.
Third down and one. Tom Yance, of course, will be providing the coverage for you. Wrote a nice piece in yesterday's Hartford Current previewing the game. Deep throw downfield intended for Bleszczynski is incomplete. Bobby Irison was back with him in coverage, stride for stride. Throw is off the mark. And it'll be at the 44-yard line. Stops the clock. I'm sorry, Chris. It's 6:07 prior to the second and 10 at the Conard 44.
You know, I mean, you can make light of it, but again, a Hall touchdown here puts it into a very, they haven't used any timeouts. It puts it into a very possible situation. Not probable, but possible.
Yeah, they could force another turnover. There's Ferengi over the middle. He's got it inside the 30. Spins down to the 25. Picks up 19. Pitch and catch between Wilcox and Ferengi. Stops the clock with a first down.
Tell you what, you've got to be impressed with the junior Ferengi. Between Ferengi and Bleszczynski, they've got a couple of skill guys coming back that will be here to help them. I mean, he's a big, tall target who's shown some pretty good hands here in the second half.
And again, using that big height advantage. Deep ball towards the end zone, incomplete. Wells and Iverson was back with him stride for stride, and it'll be second down and 10. Really good news for Hall. It stops the clock at 5:50 to play. Can't wait to see the official numbers at the end of this game, though, to see all of the yardage. Got to be well over 1,000, both teams combined at this point. Or close to 1,000 to 1,100.
And again, I don't know how you can even watch a game film like this because there's so many mistakes on one side of the ball and so much positivity on the other side of the ball. It's just going to be tough for the coaching staffs to watch this game.
There's Bleszczynski, and it's read well this time by the Chieftains, who bring him down immediately, combining Reale and Carson on the stop. And it's going to be third down and long for the Warriors.
You know, before when they were down 25, you were talking about showing some urgency. Now you're down by 18. You really need to show some urgency here. They need to get a play in and get it going.
Third down at the 26. Here's Wilcox. Throws to his right. Incomplete. In and out of the hands that time of Chukwuera that time. Looking for his third interception of the season for the Chieftains. But it goes awry. And it'll be fourth down and 11. Back at about the 26-yard line.
Pete, you got to think that Wells is going to be a target here. If he's able to play on the near side, he's got single coverage. The safety's coming over now, but you got to think he's a target here.
Fourth down. Wilcox throwing deep right side, intended for Booth, and it's out of bounds. And that'll turn it over on downs. So he had Booth deep right side in one-on-one coverage that time with the Chieftains secondary. But they turn it over, and here are the Chieftains with the ball, first and 10, at the 26-yard line at the 5:11 mark, time remaining here in the fourth quarter.
After this play, we're going to take some time to point out the seniors on both teams for today's game, Pete.
Okay, Chris, first down and 10. Here's Richem running to his right, out of a tackle again, crosses the 30, across the 35, and out near the 38-yard line. And another first down for the Chieftains with a flag down on the play as he was brought down by Justin Searles.
The linesman there is yelling at the chain gang to move it. He didn't realize there was a flag down, so he's going to have to relax a little bit here on the near side. I think he's got the happy hour plan scheduled, so he's going to be going backwards. Now he's relaxing with his hands on his hips. For Hall, we've got some seniors to announce. Amari Bartley, as it was coming back on the offense. Aaron Bellucci, John Marco, Giovanni Garcia, Jack Kanaga, Austin Kerr, Harrison Newman, Angel Rodriguez, Tyler Strickling, Jordan Weinstock, John Wells, Matthew Wilcox, and Jacob Zedoff.
Here's Richem again, 35-40, and dragged down at the 41-yard line with the first down. So he continues to add to his 400-plus-yard total at the 41-yard line. Booth and Strickland combine on the stop. First and 10 at the 41-yard line.
You know, part of Conard's success in this football game has been that they haven't huddled, so they've kept the tempo going. But that's another reason why Hall's been able to stick around in the game, because they haven't used any clock. If you run the ball for almost 500 yards and you don't use any clock by doing it, it kind of defeats the purpose.
Well, the problem is that he gains first downs all the time. Stops the clock. He stays in bounds. And here's Richem again. 45, 50. He's going to go. 40, 30, 20, 10, 5. Touchdown. 59 yards for Richem. And how close is he going to be now to the half century mark, or the 500-yard mark?
He's had a pretty good day, Pete. I think Tom Yance's story might be writing itself right now. He's approaching the Connecticut High School state record, I believe. The state record is 565 yards. He's got 498. So if Conner gets the ball, unofficially 498, if Conner gets the ball back within their own territory, you got to think he's a betting favorite to break that record. Unbelievable.
66 to 41. Cahill, 9 extra points on the day, has 55 extra points on the season. Of course, this by 8 points, eclipsing the high point total of the season for the Chieftains, which they had established a week ago with the 58 at Newington. So 4:08 to go, 66-41, and Chris again paying tribute to the Conard seniors.
Okay, Pete, Joshua Augusto, Kaseon Banks, Zachary Baum, Kiernan Boyd, Thomas Callahan, Tyler Carson, Grayson Carter, Jessen Cherian, Lucas DeCellis, Jordan Dorfman, Ian Geardy, Torrey Green, Elijah Hales, Joshua Henry, Robert Iverson, Byron Jones Jr., Nicholas Cranmis, Jonathan Lee, Matthew Lee, Kyle Pena Green, Devin Pence, Carson Reale, Zachary Reed, Jack Ryan, Phil Simplicio, Saquon Small, Connor Swatton, Michael Tweet, and most importantly, Nate Richem.
Saving the most dynamic for last, as Cahill tees it up at the 40-yard line. What's lost in all the dynamics of Richem is Cahill establishing the single-season PAT mark, which we talked about earlier in the broadcast. Good boom and kick this time. Goes to the 20-yard line, as that's Graham on the return. Crosses the 25 and out to about the 27-yard line. Kyron Bridges, special teams tackle for the Conard Chieftains. Penalty on the play. And an unsportsmanlike being assessed against the Chieftains.
Well, Pete, this is one of the more impressive individual performances in state history. I mean, when a guy has just a few yards unofficially shy of 500 at any level, video game or reality, but when a guy does it in a rivalry game as a senior to help his team go towards the playoffs, it is gone from changing this tone from, wow, that was a crazy game, to making it the Richem game. And it is now the Richem game. It will always be the Richem game. The guy runs for 500 yards and 5 touchdowns. He puts his spot. He's basically immortal around in West Hartford now. No matter what he does for the rest of his career, Nate Richem will always be known for leading his team to the playoffs with a 500-yard, 5-touchdown, at a minimum, performance. If he gets any more work, maybe more.
Here's Wilcox. His pass tipped and almost picked. Steven Bintz, one of the defensive leaders of this Conard team. Guy that leads the Chieftains with 6.5 sacks. Able to knock that one down, and it'll be second down and 10. The other mark that he's chasing here, he started the day at 1446. He's chasing 2,000 yards, though. He's at 1944 right now. And he's eclipsed 56 yards at a time, so it's not beyond the realm. There's a pitch and catch into Conard territory, down to about the 47-yard line. Ferengia makes the catch, gains about 10 or 11, and has a first down at the Conard 47-yard line. 66-41, the Chieftains by 25, and I can assure you that this will be higher scoring than either of the two boys' basketball games that will be played in this upcoming season. They played two. They played a game in the low. They played a game in the low 40s last year that we broadcast. Straight up the middle is Strickling. Gained about a yard or two. Keeps the clock moving. DeSellis on that last stop.
Strickling for two.
Second down and eight after that two-yard advance. Here's Wilcox, throws to the near side. Too low, intended for Blaschinski.
That was the great Hall team.
Back with him was Grayson Carter. And it'll be third down. 3 minutes and 6 seconds time remaining before the Conard Chieftains.
You know, Pete, I've gone from frustration with missed tackles and not wanting, but leaning towards hoping this game would come to a conclusion at some time before nightfall, to desperately wanting for Conard to get the ball back just to see what happens with Richem, to see if they'll give him one more chance to try to put himself in a place no one else has ever been before.
Wilcox all kinds of time and finally brought down Dylan Forsberg, posting his fourth sack of the season. He's second on the team in sacks, and he throws him for a loss back at the 45-yard line. So it's fourth down and about 18. They have to get down to the 37-yard line in order to move the chains. Wilcox went to the far sideline to get the play from the coaching staff. Two wides to either side, Strickling to the right of the quarterback. And a flag down. And the false start will back the Warriors up five. Turn it into a fourth and 23 back at the 40-yard line. So the Warriors will see their season come to an end at 5-5. But again, not without a gallant second-half fight. Give them credit for putting 41 on the board here this afternoon. Fourth and 23 at the 40-yard line. Here's Wilcox, back to pass, deep downfield, and it is caught by Whitestock, and he's going to score! Whitestock, unbelievable, 60 yards on the receiving end of that pass from Wilcox. And that makes it 66-47 at the 152 mark.
Why not? Why not Weinstock? Why not now? First of all, that was an unbelievable pass and catch. I mean, Weinstock has made two great grabs here in the second, in the fourth quarter. Let's not diminish. Hall's put up 47, going on 48, possibly 49 points here. And they're going to lose by three scores. Boy, tough day for the defense out here, Peter.
Chris, combined, the two teams have gotten into the end zone 16 times. 16th touchdown of the day by Hall and Conard combined. The offense stays on the field as they go for two. There's Bartley, takes the carry, and he does not make it. So the first defensive statement in a long time. And that keeps it at 66-47. And will we see Richem? That's a debatable situation here.
The real problem is that if they do win this game, which looks to be the case here, they've got another game in a very short period of time against a much better football team than they played today. It would be purely... I don't want to say stupidity, but it would be very questionable to bring him back out there when you don't have Dorfman. He's your only guy. So from a selfish perspective, I'd like to see it. But honestly, I hope we don't, because you don't want a repeat of what happened with Dorfman. You can't afford it. I mean, if he's not playing, then you might as well not come to the game. So you got to get him out. Give him a rest. I think he's done his part here with the 498 and five touches. I think that's a pretty solid day at the office.
Can I put him on my FanDuel team?
It's totally illegal.
Yeah. Think of the points.
These are that's Andre Ware, David Klingler. Type.
Yeah, pretty much. So here's Rodriguez with the ball teed up at the 40. And they actually kick it further downfield. And the fair catch is made inside the 30 at the 29-yard line. And Conard goes back on offense, first down and 10 inside their own 30-yard line.
All right, Pete, here's the moment of truth. I see a lot of small bodies out there. He would only need unofficially, like we said, 2 or 3 yards to go over that 500-yard mark, but he's not going to do it. As all the backups are in, which is good here, as it is the last game at home for any of these players, so it's a good opportunity for them to see the field in a rivalry game.
Max Main has replaced Richmond as the tailback in the Conard backfield, and Main gets the carry as he comes to the near side, and he's wrapped up by Drew Booth and thrown down for a short loss. And it will be second down and long as the clock ticks down inside of 100 seconds to play here in the contest. Second down, back at the 26-yard line. It looks like Matt Lee. Matt Lee is in at quarterback. So it's a Lee and Main backfield for the Chieftains. There's Main again, shy of the 30-yard line. Booth among those in on the middle of the pile. Evan Duzan also came over and made the stop. You hear the Conard faithful as they start to voice their approval of a Chieftains victory here. They're going to win for the first time in 5 years in this rivalry game. Hasn't been since John Esposito's gallant effort back in 2010 over at Chalmers, but the Chieftains have won this game.
I mean, Pete, what did Esposito run for? A meager 275 yards? I mean, in the grand scheme of things, what is that really?
So there it is. The Conard Chieftains have won it. Final score here this afternoon, Conard 66 and Hall 47. We'll come back with more right after this on WHC-TV Channel 5 as presented by the War Chief Sports Council. Paul had wanted a post game. Do we have the ability to? Yeah.
Our last tour, our administration and our service partner. We appreciate your service today.
Dual talk. We're going to talk to Sir Sosmo and Richard.
A wonderful celebration of Scott's Chieftain competition. Today's trophy presented by Mr. Scott Kuska.
Thank you. Gallant effort.
Bill, see you, sir.
Always a pleasure. And seriously, anytime, don't have to
good job, bro.
Now.
Thank you, you too.
We can just leave our headset by the camera. All right, yeah.
Is he done?
Yes, he is.
Thanks again.
Thanks, John. Appreciate it.
Anything I can do to help?
I think we have someone here to help clean up and take some boxes down, but I think we should be good.
You have that or you need that?
We're good.
All right, cool.
Sorry, what, Meredith? Yeah, say that again? I'm gonna call you because I can't hear you right now.
Where's Pete?
His way down, actually. Bye. Me? Oh, okay. Well, do you know how to take down the camera? That's all right. That's fine. Don't worry about it.
I mean, I can wait and help. Wire.
Okay, Meredith, can you hear this mic? Testing. Testing.
Meredith? Okay, so what did you say? Well, it should be, because I plugged the mic in. Hold on. This should be on. Mic should be on. Or how about now? Testing, testing, 1, 2, testing, 1, 2. Testing, testing.
It's only coming in 2 minutes.
Testing, that's... Wait, this sounds directly, like you can hear it from the mic? Okay. The levels are good? Wait, did you change the battery on this one?
I did.
Why is it dying? Okay. All right, I'm gonna run back up and grab another battery because I don't want this to die while it while they do it. Okay, hold on. Never a dull moment.
Oh, there's a key. I'll go tell them.
Okie dokie.
Hey Dan,
how you doing?
Good, you?
Good. I know, neither is Daddy. I know, me too.
Hey, where's Pete?
He's with the coach. He's gonna bring him over.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay. He knows to come to this camera.
He does, I told him.
Oh, okay, cool. Okay, yeah, no, he does. All right, I'll, okay, we should be good when he gets here. I'll let him know about the time.
Okay.
Okay, bye. We can't have our program on for scheduled for a certain amount of time, so we only have like 10 minutes.
He'll be here in 10 minutes. And if not, we can always just add it to the rebroadcast later. Sound good? You got 10 minutes left? We'll be done within 10 minutes.
I'm trying to think how we can record it. Well, I guess we can get
He's coming
recorded
right now.
From...
We'll be done within 2 minutes.
Oh, okay, cool.
Congratulations, Coach.
Thank you.
Big release. Yeah. On the States, man.
We'll see. We will see. Thank
okay,
you.
Hold on. I'm going to grab Meredith and make sure that we can check your levels.
Oh, sure.
Okay, I have you on right now, but I just wanted to make sure that I can get back to you to check levels. So I'll have you can talk right now.
Okay.
Perfect.
Can you hear us?
Okay, we're good. Okay, cool.
Matt Sersosmo has been coming to this game since 1987, the Ice Bowl, when you were 10 years old. Mom brought you home at halftime because it was really, really cold. How does this one rank up with all the ones in your lifetime?
All these games are awesome. They are. I mean, win or lose. Obviously, it's better to be on the winning side of things.
Sure.
But this one was great because I'm so happy for our seniors. Since they've been here, they've never had the opportunity to know what it feels like to beat Hall at the varsity level. So to see them and the jubilation and just the look on their faces is priceless.
The last time that Conard beat Hall was 2010. John Esposito, before he went on his way to Princeton, had an unbelievable day. How about Nate Richmond? Twice of what Esposito did in terms of yardage today. Unofficially, Matt, 498 yards. We did the math. That's a quarter of a mile.
He's going to need some ice today. I can't tell you enough about Nate. I mean, and he would be the first to tell you if he was standing here that he can't tell you enough about his teammates. That's the kind of kid he is. And he's a team-oriented person first. He's an intelligent young man. So everything he gets, he deserves. He really does, because he's that kind of special person. But he'd be standing here and telling you that if it wasn't for the 10 linemen that were blocking for him, or the 10 other football players, excuse me, he wouldn't have the success that he's having. But he's a special, special player. With all that being said, he's a special player. I'm very lucky to have him.
So now you wait till Turkey Day.
Yes.
8-2. You came in this week, 7th in Class OOL, and probably will not hurt that ranking. So, but you'll keep your fingers crossed. It's not 100% done deal, but we'll see what happens.
But this is what I'm going to tell the team when we get back in the locker room: is we've done everything we can, and now we just have to wait and see. But we need to be really happy and proud of where we've come from to finish 8-2, and the seniors have really done a nice job of getting the program back and getting the program back to the winning ways. And it's a lot of credit. All the credit goes to them and the coaches, to be honest with you.
Happy Thanksgiving. Congratulations, Matt, and thank you for all you've done helping us prepare for the games. You've been terrific.
Thank you. I'm glad to help any way I can.
Terrific.
Thanks, we appreciate it.
Thanks, Matt. You too. Matt Sersosmo, the head coach of the Conard Chieftains. His team wins here this afternoon at McKee Stadium. They conclude the regular season at 8-2, and they'll wait for their Class OOL playoff assignment, which will take place on December 1st. Thanks to everybody involved with the broadcast here this afternoon. It was really a terrific game, one for the ages. Paul McConnell, Dennis Swanton, thank you very much. Thanks to everybody from WHC-TV, led by Jen Evans, and all the crew as we brought the victory here this afternoon for the Conard Chieftains, their first in this rivalry game, the 59th renewal, their first victory over Hall since 2010. For all of us here at McKee Stadium, so long, everybody.
That's a wrap.
Nicely done. Nicely done.
Thanks, Paul.